Live now.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the March 5th, 2015 Harbor Board Advisory Meeting. Thank you. We have some attendance tonight, and it looks like we have a quorum, and everyone is in attendance. So thank you for showing up. I'd like to have a moment of silence. And then I'd like to do a pledge of allegiance to the flag.
To the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Okay, at this time, I'd like to see if any of the board members have any announcements or presentations. Gene? Alan?
None.
Lynn?
Nope.
I do not. Neil?
None.
Dana?
Always.
Always.
Yeah, I would just like to announce next weekend, the 14th and 15th of March, we will be having the 9th annual Big Rock Regatta hosted by the Morro Bay Yacht Club. This is an entry-level class of boats. We'll have boats from all over Southern California and actually a few from the Bay Area, San Francisco. Last year we had 71. We split it up into two fleets. And so we'll be down between the mooring fields off the past south of the launch ramp with our green fleet, our beginners. And we hope to be in the entrance area if there's not a lot of swell with our championship fleet like we've done in the last 2 years. So it's quite a sight to see all these little white sails out there. So while you're cruising around, check it out.
Thank you, Dana. Ron?
Two announcements. One relates to the, I believe, the 25th annual Dixon Spaghetti Dinner. It's a fundraiser. I wasn't smart enough to bring my notes, so I'm handicapped. I believe it's Friday evening, March 20th. Tickets are available at the Parks and Recreation Department in the community center, upstairs in the community center, and at the senior center. And it's all of the proceeds, virtually all of the proceeds, go to the benefit of kids participating in the City of Morro Bay Recreation Department organized sports and recreation activities. Specifically, they're earmarked for scholarships for children and families who otherwise might not be able to participate in those. So we encourage everybody to come out. There will be some raffles, there will be some auctions, there will be lots of pasta, and a good time had by all. Secondly, in April, and I don't remember the exact dates, and I don't have a calendar in front of me, but I believe it's the third weekend in April is the annual Morro Bay Citywide Yard Sale. And for those who would like to become sellers and get themselves on the much-coveted treasure map for the yard sale, which is handed out by sponsoring businesses here in Morro Bay to anybody that comes in, and hundreds of people literally come in from all over, as far away as 200 or 300 miles. It's quite astonishing. I know some of the people that live here decide that that's a good weekend to leave town, but it's a big deal, and you can register if you're interested in selling. I believe the website is www.morrobaybeautiful.com, and there's an application form in there. Thank you.
Thank you, Ron. Okay, at this time, any members of the audience that have anything to say that is not on our agenda, this is the time for public comment. Is there anyone here that would like to have public comment? Please state your name.
Drew Jacobson. I live work on Morro Bay.
I'd like to pay a compliment to the Harbor Department. 2 weeks ago, I was out on a charter, and the engine that we had had a catastrophic breakdown about a mile and a half out. No wind. Called for Harbor Patrol. They came out. They were professional, efficient, and friendly. Gave us a tow back into the harbor, handed us off to Jim Sanders. So I'd like to just pay a compliment on that.
Thank you, Drew. Good job, Eric.
Again, definitely. Mike Rowland, they call me Bear.
Okay.
I live in and on and about Morro Bay. Again, Harbor Department has been just this year awesome. All right. There's been a lot of things that have been going on around us that they've taken care of really well. The kayakers and this little regatta that's down by my boat is a lot of fun. It's all good. Morro Bay has been beautiful the past couple of days, and let's just keep it up. Congratulations, Neil. I didn't see you here before. I haven't been here before. And Bill, you're sitting in there. Everybody else, hello. You all know me, I guess. So have a good evening.
Thank you.
Thanks, sir. Thank you for the compliment. Okay, with that.
Oh,
I'm sorry.
That's okay. My name's Richard Boren. I live aboard with my family in Morro Bay. I'm sure the board may be aware or maybe isn't aware, so I wanted to just kind of raise the issue of the difficulty at the pump-out docks. Some vessels that are larger with limited drafts are only able to maneuver up to certain pump-out docks. Primarily the one at Tidelands Park is the one we've been usually going to. And due to the circumstance of vessels tying up either all day, all weekend, all through the nights, it makes that dock and pump out dock specifically unavailable at many times of the day, full weekends at the time. So I wanted I know I've talked to the Harbor Patrol about it. Anytime I've told them I need to get to the dock, they've always been very accommodating to go over, ask the boats that are there to, you've been there all day, can you move? And I know in the past they had talked about making the section at the base of the ramp where the pump out dock is, either with the painted curb or something to give it priority to the pump out. Because I don't have a problem if people want to stay there all day. I know it's not allowed, but I know I'm just trying to get in and out for a pump out. And I go over, I ask, I get the look of, kind of, so I'm just trying to get into the pump out dock, and I know there's maybe other vessels that are liveaboards that have the same problem, but nobody wants to be the person to bring it up, to cause a problem. But I'm, raising my family aboard, trying to set good examples of, look, we go to the pump out dock every weekend, this is what we do, it's part of living aboard. So I just wanted to bring that to the board's attention to see if there's some easy resolution, a simple sign, painted curb, just more acknowledgement that area next to the pump out dock really needs to be for pump outs.
Thank you very much, Richard. We actually did talk about the Tidelands Park, some of the concerns of people being on there last meeting. Is that correct, Eric? What didn't we, Gene? And I forget what we said we were going to do. What was that, Gene?
Some signage.
I think there was some signage that we were going to at least try to put up. So we did bring that up. We didn't bring up your specific on the pump haul-out facility area. Now, that's another reason why we need to monitor that a little bit better. And so, but thank you.
All right, thank you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, the Harbor Advisory Board, city staff. My name is Jeremiah O'Brien. I'm here representing the Morro Bay Commercial Fishermen's Organization. And there's an extremely, extremely important issue, and I can't tell you how important it is to our community. So I don't have much time, so I'm going to run through this briefly. It deals with this current sanctuary application to turn the waters here off of our area into a national marine sanctuary. And there's a lot of misinformation going around. There's a paper came out today referring everyone to the Chumash website on this issue. And everything on that website can be refuted. No one can tell you that there will be no loss of community community, you'll lose all of the community governance and so forth. No one can tell you there won't be, because each and every one of these sanctuaries operates on its own specific charter. In any case, I'm gonna have to be quick here. So I gave you a couple of handouts, and now what I think a person should do in doing due diligence would be to check the areas that are currently, we've got four areas currently, living under the umbrella of National Marine Sanctuaries. So in your handouts, one of them is a permit. So Monterey Bay, Monterey, the city of Monterey, wanted to do some work on Wharf Number 1 and Wharf Number 2. So this is the acceptance of the permit. So I'm going to take these things out of context, but you have it in its entirety, so you can read it all. So on the page number 2, middle paragraph, any direct or incidental harassment of marine mammals requires a permit from the National Marine Fisheries Service. Direct or incidental harassment of seabirds requires a permit from the Fish and Wildlife Service, U.S. Fish and Wildlife. Now, this permit was to get a soil sample. They wanted to do some work on Wharf Number 1 and Wharf Number 2. Think about, like, North Teeper and South Teeper. And then it goes on to say, the last sentence, the enclosed permit is not valid until all of the other necessary permits are in place. So to do the soil sample, you have to get permits to harassment for birds and harassment for mammals. So you've got to stack up a whole bunch of permits here. So now I'm going to go to the permit itself. Page, it's actually page 3. So this is the permit itself. I'm going to go to number 2. And number 2 says, permitted activities shall be limited to the collection of approximately 4 cups of sand from the seabed offshore in Monterey in the areas adjacent to Wharf Number 1 and Wharf Number 2. 4 cups of sand. So now this alone required 3 permits to pick up 4 cups of sand to do a soil sample.
So what you're saying is that there is going to be a lot of issues.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, there's going to be issues. Now, the other paper I gave you is from CMANC. It's the California Marine Affairs and Navigation Conference. And what I gave you there is all of the members, and you'll see us included in the membership. And it's all of the cities and towns and respective harbors in California, the cities and towns with harbors. And the list is included, as well as corporate members. Now, on the back of that, there is a legislative policy statement. And the legislative policy statement, I'm going to read 2, but you have them in their entirety. CMANC supports the preservation of the nation's oceans through congressionally established marine sanctuaries. That's number 1. Number 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 are problems that they are currently having with the sanctuaries in their area. Remember, these include all of the sanctuaries, so we're not talking about one specific one. So number 7 indicates CMANC recommends suspending the expansion of existing sanctuaries until the problems identified above are resolved. Now, the question I have is, why would we want, in an area like this, I think we're incredibly good stewards of this area, why would we want to invite what others apparently are seeing as problems to our area? These are the people living there. These are our peers. These are the harbors and the cities and the towns. So I think, actually, what I ask everybody is just to do due diligence on this whole thing. What are you going to gain, and what are you going to lose? And to remember that once you take the step, and once this county takes that step, there's no reverse.
Jeremiah, where is the process at right now? I did read in the paper that they did apply for it, the Chumash Indian Tribe. Is that correct?
It's the Chumash and the Sierra Club and the Surf Riders. The Sierra Club spearheaded this. They've been spearheading it. And frankly, and I'll go on record saying it, the Sierra Club looked at the Chumash as their key to the back door. The Sierra Club is the one who put out an economic paper. We have a study. They have a paper. I can't release this study now. It's still under peer review, but I can sit down with each and every one of you if you'd like and discuss it and bring your attention to any of the issues it addresses. It addresses them all.
So where is our city's position right now, Jeremiah?
It is on the agenda for an upcoming, I believe, the 23rd or 4th city council meeting. It's on the agenda on the county board. It's on the agenda of the Cayucas Council. The reason we are so far behind in bringing this forward is because we were not notified of the original application. Once there's a six-step process with the federal government. So process number one is submission of the application. The application was submitted. It was accepted by Bill Duros, who is head of all of the sanctuaries on the coast of the West Coast. It was accepted on February 2nd. So at that point, it went into the next step, which is 90 days of public input. So we're well into the public input phase, and then after that, it rolls on. Then we have no input. We were not notified. Supervisor in our area sent a letter of recommendation for the sanctuary. I've got the letter. It was dated December 15th, before it was even gone out for public input. The mayor and none of the members of the city council were spoken to by our representation in the county. We were not spoken to, and all of the sport groups that I've talked to, all of them, have not been spoken to. So we were basically polarized on this issue up until a few weeks ago, and we've found ourselves now scrambling to catch up with this process. So,
thank you, Jeremiah. Let us know if we can help you.
I'd like to see it on the agenda.
Okay.
And regardless of the place on this issue, as far as the timeline, I would like to see it come up on the agenda and see our Harbor Advisory Board take a position one way or another, regardless.
Okay.
So thank you
very
much.
We'll talk about it. Dana, question?
I was going to say we have questions.
Oh, do we have any questions? Oh, I apologize. Do we have any questions for Jeremiah?
I do.
Okay, Dana. Jeremiah, sorry.
No.
Getting used to this middle chair here.
No problem.
So when you're talking about the notification that evidently nobody has received, and yet one of our supervisors, what are you talking about, county supervisor?
Our county supervisor, yes, for our area.
Okay.
So again, we feel fairly polarized here when everybody else had notification and we were not, you know, even if that person did not agree with our position, he is sworn to represent this area, and we are the area as far as, you know, we have the major port, we have the major fishing, we have harbor and everything else to protect here. The least someone could do is show a little bit of common courtesy to sit down and talk with us whether or not they agreed with our position.
And so you're saying 90 days from February 2nd, we have basically 2 months of
we
public
have until
comment?
May 2nd and the door will slam. Correct.
Thank you.
Wow. Okay. No other questions? Anyone else? Matt? Thank you.
I'd like to, as Matt Makowski, City Council, and I'd like to represent, talk and answer.
Mr. Makowski, would you identify yourself, please?
You just did.
I just did. Matt Makowski, City Council.
Oh, sorry. That was too fast for me.
That's all right. I do that in the classroom sometimes also. I would like to comment simply to totally agree with what Jeremiah is talking about. In terms of City Council, this has not formally come to City Council. I've spoken both to Jeremiah and to the Chumash representative in the last probably 10 days. And so as city council representative, and we haven't formally discussed this as a city council. And so the reason I would like to get up and talk is because this is very imperative to just our harbor, our area. And so with that said, to the public out at large and then to the Harbor Advisory Group, we need to get feet on the ground talking to people about this and find out. Jeremiah makes a very good point. Because I think looking at the last 20 years, our various MPAs here locally, and I think you look at the various sanctuaries up and down the coast, and so I'm trying to be kind of middle of the road here to say, to be fair to all voices out there, to say, whatever you're going to say, now's the time to get up and say it. We have a meeting, I do believe, I haven't seen it formally agendized yet, but I do believe it's coming the 24th of March. But that's a couple weeks away, so what I would I think I saw that tentatively on there. But we have another meeting coming on the 10th of March. And so now is the time for you folks, Harbor Advisory, but also public in Morro Bay, to stand up and start expressing your various interests. And because I think this is larger than just outside of the harbor marine sanctuaries, we're talking about, as Jeremiah is talking about, things going on inside the bay, various oyster farming going on in the bay. This is a wide swath of our immediate area. So I'd encourage everybody to get out there.
Thank you.
Yes.
That meeting on March 10th, that it's not on the agenda for that meeting?
No, it's not. So I'm thinking since it's not, it could be looking, and I haven't seen the March 24th meeting agenda either. Okay, but what I say with that is come out and have voices heard in public comment. And, you know, as much as we can have put feet on the ground and getting reason out there and expressing those reasons. Yes?
Thanks, Matt.
Mm-hmm.
Ron? Matt, do either you and or Jeremiah know of a particular resource, an online resource or something where citizens of Morro Bay and for that matter the Harbor Advisory Board members can go to educate themselves about the particulars of this proposed sanctuary, its location, its scope, and so on?
I'm sure Jeremiah could speak a lot more fuller to this than I, but what I've done after I've spoken to the various parties is call up people in different harbors, get online, look up the various marine sanctuaries, and look at the parameters that those sanctuaries have proposed in the last 20, 25 years. And then me, coming into it fairly as a neophyte, I'm like, okay, how will this work? And then to go ask various people what they think could come down the road. In terms of resources, I'm going to say just go to those existing marine sanctuaries. I don't know, Jeremiah, do you have any idea of where people could go?
Is it on the Chumash site, Jeremiah, the proposal?
It is, yeah, and you'll get everything you want to know about their side of the story.
All right. So Chumash.com?
Yeah. Where will you find out about the other side of the story?
No, I'm saying...
Well, my principle... Well,
get everything you want to know about... What they perceive.
Jeremiah, my principal interest is a resource where people who are interested can learn about this particular sanctuary application.
There is no resource, Ron, for that, and there's a lot of reasons for it. Although I have a list of harbor managers from a group of harbors in our area, north and south of us here, and their contact information, and I'd be more than happy to give it to you. Those are people living under it. There isn't a resource for it. The only resource we have for it is this study right here. And I'd be more than happy to let you go through it. I can't release it, unfortunately. It hasn't completed peer review, and the scientists don't let these things out until they are completed, peer reviewed.
Now, we have a ton. I've got reams of information on it and contacts and letters from Congress people. The problem with it is, even though in their charter that they're supposed to abide by, they have gone outside the rules in their charter. And there's really nothing you can do when they do that. And the problems, some of the problems are listed there in the paper I gave you. And when they go outside the charter, such as they say they're not managing fisheries. Okay, well, they're not managing fisheries. Good, that's on their charter. They have to abide by that. Sam Farr had that put into their charter. Well, they help craft all of these marine sanctuaries. I mean, marine protected areas up and down the coast. And they submitted these, worked on them, and submitted them to the state for to be accepted. And in many cases, they were. So now, if that isn't managing fisheries, we can't fish there. Certainly seems like management to us. And they were part and parcel of that whole process. I've got a letter from Paul Michel, who's currently the director, detailing his part in that process. So our option, sue the United States government. So basically, we don't have an option. So whatever this is like signing a treaty. You're signing a treaty with the federal government. You're turning your area, you're turning your cities and counties over to the federal government for management. So I think we've done a fine job ourselves. If there was a problem here, I think we'd fix it in this area ourselves. We've done a fine job up until now. But I'll be happy to give you whatever information I've got, Ron, into all the contacts that I have. And I've got some really good ones. The Harbor Master of Monterey Bay.
All right, one more here, Alan.
Yeah, Jeremiah, I believe I got an email link to the actual application to the Sanctuary Selection Committee. Are you familiar with, that application is out there in public record, right?
The Sanctuary Advisory Committee.
That's what it's called?
Yes. The Sanctuary Advisory Committees are much like your Harbor Advisory Committee here, and they are appointed positions appointed by the director of the Sanctuary.
Back up. Yeah. I mean, the Chumash application for consideration of their new sanctuary has been filed with Bill Duros, and I believe that's a public document, isn't it?
It is.
And I think Ron was asking where he could find that particular document.
I'm sorry. That document would be, I would not go, I'd go there just to see what they have on their website. You want to check out that side, too.
Well, it's on the NOAA website.
And you can also get to it through sanctuary nominations at NOAA.gov. Sanctuary nominations at NOAA.gov.
Thanks, Alan. Okay. Any other questions? Thank you, gentlemen. Bear?
Hello. Good evening. Michael Rowland, Bear. My question is that how the Sierra Club and the Chumash have anything to do with fishing? Have they ever been in fishing? I've spent my whole life in this industry, and we're about ready to lose my whole life because there's no work here. Right? Are they going to demand us to lose our businesses, to lose our income? Who are they to tell us or talk to us about our fisheries? That's my question.
Thank you. Okay, any other comments for the public here? Seeing none?
I will move forward. Thank you very much. It is a interesting topic. I don't understand why there's no public input before any type of decision is made, but I guess stranger things have been done, right? And hopefully we can derail this, or at least come to some, have some forums at least to discuss the pros and cons of it. The consent calendar, if everyone's had a chance to look at the minutes from the Harbor Advisory Board meeting held on February 5th, does anyone see any corrections or any
changes to that? Neil?
Yes, I have a correction on page 2, paragraph 3 at the end. It says that she, me, believes it would be better not to make the sea lions welcome or comfortable, and that HPO should be using the water cannon to scare the sea lions away, and then they might not return to the bay. I don't believe that is what I said. It certainly is not what I intended to say. We're not going to chase the sea lions away from the bay, but we can discourage the numbers of them that are making this their home, perhaps.
Thank you. So noted. Do you have that, Lori? Any other? If not, can I have a motion?
I would move that we approve the minutes.
I hear a second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Consent calendar passes. Okay, the public hearings, reports, and appearances. This is the time that the Harbor Department gives their status report. Eric, you're on the agenda here.
Thank you, and good evening. I will add, it sounds like we've got a future agenda item coming up for Sanctuary, but I was looking at the tentative agenda planning for the next few meetings. I don't see it on there yet, but the tentative agendas are constantly a work in progress. So I know we're going back to Washington, D.C. next week with the mayor and city manager, and Sanctuary is one of the first things on our list. So hopefully we can get some good information back in D.C. and come back. And I suspect that once we do that, the Sanctuary issue may gel onto the agenda somewhere along there. But we'll see. I know that the nomination process, it's been nominated. It has to pass a first level of review by NOAA staff, and they give it a thumbs up, thumbs down, just purely based on do they think it lacks merit to go forward into a major public process. So a lot of steps, like Jeremiah said, there's like 6 steps in the process, and this is step 1 or 2, I think. So a long way to go if it goes anywhere. So sounds like we'll be talking about it in April. Status report. I did want to add another sort of announcement thing. The local flotilla of the Coast Guard Auxiliary is putting on some courses this summer. They're putting on 8-hour boating safety courses and 4-hour courses titled Suddenly in Command. In other words, you know, something happens to the skipper and you're on the boat, what are you supposed to do? So look for Recreation and Parks Department, I think maybe teaming up with the Coast Guard Auxiliary for that. So look for the city's website for those classes coming up. Early this summer is when they say they're going to have them, but I haven't seen any dates yet. Status report, recent city council action. On February 24th, 2015, a couple meetings ago, council received input from mainly the city manager and the city attorney on the update on the status of the Dynegy Power Plant property. Interesting staff report, pretty long, full of a lot of good information. I'll try and boil it down to the real basics. The triangle lot, the parking lot in the southwest corner that we've been able to use for parking for the last year and a half, that is now owned by the city. I guess the deeds and everything are done, signed off. Everybody's city and Dynegy have signed on that, and we are now the proud owners of that lot. Next steps for that are to cut down the block wall to about a 3 or 4 foot height to open it up so it isn't such a kind of hidden away spot. Put in some parking improvements to try and line up people. I think we're going to use a lot of our spare plastic pilings that we've got laying out at the end of the dirt road. Then whatever other wood pilings we can scrounge up, we'll be kind of arranging some piles out there and some signage. And I think the other plan is to, you've got 2 driveways right next to each other that get, the one going in the lot, the one going in the front street lot that aren't very well coordinated for 2 public parking lot entrances. So they're going to be combined into one coming from the front street lot and moving over into the triangle lot. So that will be coming up here fairly soon, hopefully. The power plant didn't transfer any property over in lieu of the $525,000 community development payment that they were obligated. They're negotiating with interim city attorney Ann Russell about a year ago, and then continued on with Joe Pannoni and trying to come to some sort of terms with some property to turn over. Under consideration was Lila Kaiser, our gear storage lot, yard area with the fisherman's gear storage, and a few other empty open space, but power plant didn't want to transfer any of it, so they ended up paying the last of the payment. The fisherman's gear storage yard and our harbor department storage yard, they're under an easement that for all intents and purposes is permanent. It can only be revoked by the owner if it's needed for power plant. I think the way it's worded is for power plant modernization use, and that, as we know, that's pretty well done and gone. So pretty much got a permanent easement. And then Lila Kaiser is on an easement or an agreement as well that's got similar stipulations. If it's needed for power plant, power generation uses, the power plant can take it back. So it'll probably be renewed for another 10 years here fairly soon. Dines, you had the property listed for sale. It was kind of a buzz going around town, and it got pulled off. I guess they didn't get any offers that were likely to go anywhere with them, so they've pulled it off the market. From what we understand, Dines is trying to just sell the whole thing as a lot, and that's why they didn't want to transfer any more property over to the city. The more together, the more valuable it is, so we'll see where it goes. City does have a little bit of control over the destiny of that whole property through zoning. But it's private property, and the power plant owners can, do what they want within the limits of, coastal and other permitting agencies. Also, at the February 24th meeting, the City Council adopted its goals and objectives for 2 years, and then just Tuesday evening they had another study session on goals and objectives, coming up with some prioritizing. I wasn't there. I was out of town on business, but they did some prioritizing, I guess, of some of the objectives. As it relates to the Harbor Department, there's a pretty high priority for an update of the general plan and the local coastal plan, which are our planning and building and guidance documents that the city has, that every city has. So that's pretty high on the priority list, and that's going to get going. Along with that, we'll probably be the waterfront master plan, starting to look into that as it relates to both of those plans and updating and modernizing that. Maintaining core public safety services and IT. Proactive enforcement, they're looking at maybe hiring a code enforcement officer for the city, who not quite sure what department that person will live in, but they're looking at getting some code enforcement back, and then emergency plan updates, tsunami plan and mass casualty plan and drought plan, lots of different plans, emergency plans the city has, so we'll be updating those. And then they looked at a lot of fiscal sustainability objectives, retooling the budget process. There's a financial oversight body that's going to be established. Citizens advisor body, much like the Measure Q group that oversees and helps with the city with budgeting and oversees that. Fuller fee recovery, we're looking at the master fee schedule to see for really and truly recovering all of our fees. I know at planning and building, they've historically recovered about half of what it actually costs to process those fees, so they'll be looking at that. And then a capital replacement strategy. The city in general, the general fund has never really set aside money for capital projects. They just, as it's become available and the projects become priorities, they get funded. We have in a not an exact way, but we've got our accumulation fund, and that's our capital reserve. So when we make extra money, which we have in a lot of years, and thankfully for the last couple of years, we have more revenues than expenses. Those monies go into our accumulation fund, and that goes towards capital projects, as you know, primarily. The big ticket items of piers and boats and vehicles and all that kind of stuff. So we'll be looking at a more strategic capital replacement plan with the city, where each facility is going to be looked at for when it needs to be replaced, at what year, and then amortize it out of those number of years, and then put away that much money every year on all the big facilities. So we'll see how that plays out. And then the management partners group, as you recall, or maybe you recall, a couple of years ago, Management Partners City hired a consultant to come in and look at multiple strategies for revenue enhancement and cutting costs and efficiencies. Some of those things were implemented back in, I want to say the original was probably back in 2008. Some of them were implemented over 2008, 2009, 2010. A lot of them weren't. City's taken a new look at that. They've hired Management Partners to update that whole study. And that should be coming out fairly soon, I think towards the end of this month. And then we'll be looking to council to make a decision on each and every one, whether, okay, we're going to do that and send staff on their way to go implement it or reject it as not being viable. So that'll be coming down the pike here fairly soon. And then,
Eric, yep. Isn't one of the objectives that I read in the management study outsourcing the leasing of the waterfront?
There were a couple of recommendations back in the original report for the city to consider basically contracting out for the Harbor Patrol and contracting out for lease management with a private entity like WestTrek. I mean, there's some entities that manage marinas. The trouble is we're not, you know, a traditional marina with 1,000 or 500 slips. We're a harbor with all kinds of other things that we do. So we'll see where it goes. It'll be interesting to see how they update. They did a lot of interviewing of myself and my staff and a lot of other city staff and citizens. So we'll see what comes out of that. And the city's looking at a leasing policy instead of buying vehicles. So we may be ending up leasing instead of buying here in the near future. Another goal, supporting economic development, Boatyard, that was pretty high on the list. That's one of my goals and objectives that I'm still continuing to work on. Maritime Museum, working with the agreement and getting that moving forward and continuing to move forward. Then looking at the aquarium site. We're tomorrow, I'm going down to Avila to meet with some city staff and a couple of city council folks to go meet with the Avila Aquarium folks and see where they're at in terms of where their interest may still be in coming here. And then the Coast Guard facility. Where the status on that, and I was going to have a little more robust information here, but I neglected to put it in. But basically where the Coast Guard is, they've created a couple MOUs. The city gave the Coast Guard the okay to start processing for building on that empty lot, the empty lease sites where the restroom is, mostly empty. And they're processing an MOU for that. That's their mechanism that they want to used for to ensure that the city's on board with that. They're processing a concurrent MOU with using our site where our harbor office is. Trouble is you know, we don't have funding and planning and don't know where we would go. So, but they're putting that out there as a potential option. So next steps with that, once they get that MOU and assuming the city signs it, I'm assuming they're going to need to start submitting for plans and going to the planning department and putting their proposal all together. And moving forward with that, and then we'll be looking at the main thing for us is figuring out where to put that restroom. And another objective on economic development was the Tidelands Park Fish Cleaning Station. Actually made it on as a goal. I had applied for a grant. I think at the last HAB meeting I announced that we didn't get that grant from DBW. So we're going to be going in this year and figuring out a more long-term solution for that fish cleaning station than kind of what I was planning on doing this summer with that grant coming along. I figured I'd do something fairly small and inexpensive just to make it somewhat better, and then the bigger project would really revamp it. Well, I think we're going to have to go forward with the more bigger revamping project, so I think that'll be coming back to the Harbor Advisory Board at some point fairly soon, I hope. And then improving city infrastructure, facilities, open spaces. We're looking at the potential of establishing a promenade along the Embarcadero. Basically widening the western sidewalk in front of all our lease sites to about 15 feet, making potentially one-way traffic or two-way traffic with no parking on the Embarcadero road proper to open up and just get a lot of public open space and seating and other amenities kind of concurrent with that triangle lot, because we'll be losing a fair number of parking spaces. So the idea being that we make up those parking spaces back down to the triangle lot and get some improvements between that lot and the rest of the Embarcadero, and you walk, because, you know, everywhere else you go in this world, you walk to places. So we're kind of daylighting that and see where that goes here in the near future. Triangle lot to temporary parking, I already talked about that, and then we're doing an ADA assessment of all city facilities, and then doing, including our office, and then we're approved this budget to do a harbor office needs assessment. So that'll kind of tie in with what the Coast Guard's doing, that we get a needs assessment, which is telling, basically hiring a consultant to come in and study what our staffing and mission and equipment and all the needs are, and here's what your building should look like in size and space use wise, and then kind of tying that in with the Coast Guard move if that ends up going forward. Recent events, I know Dana announced it a couple of meetings ago, February 7th and 8th, is that right, Dana? The Cal Poly Mustang Regatta, the collegiate sailing event. UCSB took, I guess, top honors in that. Looked like a great event. Lots of boats out there, lots of activity, great weather, so it was good to see that. 25th annual Big Bad and Ugly Surf Contest was on Valentine's Day. If anybody was down there, you notice it took you about an hour to get from the Rock up to Main Street. It was probably one of the most crowded days in the city's history down there. It was crazy due to great weather, the contest, and it was Valentine's Day, and everybody was out. I know that our lifeguard supervisor, Kyle Schaefer, took third place in the men's, and retired Harbor Patrol Officer Tom Kellerman took first place in the Grand Masters.
I got wiped out of the day.
And Gene got wiped out of the day. Nicely done.
You didn't make the finals, Gene?
We put the snowy plover fencing up February 25th. Yes, it's that time of the year again. I'm asking the public to respect the fence and not go through the fenced-off areas and look for the corridors to get over to the beach and back. It's the same area, same corridors. Not much has changed. You know, there's a corridor kind of straight across from the Santa Marcadero. There's one down kind of straight across from the State Park Marina. And then I think further down, if you go back into the back bay where the oyster leases are, there's another corridor across if you end up way back in the back bay. So those will be established as well. State Parks helped us with that, as always. So I want to thank them. Cable Committee grant, we were successful in attaining about $8,900 in funding to send three of us this year back to Washington, D.C., myself, the mayor, and city manager, new city manager David Buckingham. Since he spent a fair amount of his career in Washington, D.C. and has a fair amount of contacts and know-how over there in D.C., we decided to bring him along as well and to get him quickly up to speed on all the issues. So we're flying out Sunday and then freelancing with our legislators and others, going to NOAA Fisheries, trying to meet with NOAA Sanctuary folks on Monday, and then Tuesday, Wednesday, we meet with the CMANC group that Jeremiah spoke about, California Marine Affairs and Navigation Conference. And we do the rounds over D.C., and a lot of the same folks, Corps of Engineers, National Ocean Service, NOAA Fisheries, with our legislators on the budget and ensuring, CAPS, Feinstein, Boxer, and all the financial committees that they're on, appropriations committees that they're on, and ensuring that we get funded. We are funded this year with Corps of Engineers to the tune of, I want to say, $2.06 million. I'll get to that here in a bit. Yeah, I'll get to that in a minute on the back of the page. So we're going D.C., so that's coming up quick. Our own Scott Mather attended a week-long earthquake emergency management training seminar out at Cali OES out there at the National Guard property out there. It was mainly principles of emergency management, but it was specific to an earthquake, and it was a fictitious town called, I forget, it was Santa Barbara is what the town was, but they had a fictitious town named to it. So there's tsunami and mudslides and bridges collapsing and buildings falling. It was pretty interesting. So Scott went to that. It was good training. And then the city now has its own Facebook page to keep citizens apprised of upcoming events and all kinds of things. City's getting pretty heavy into social media, and we're going to be updating the city's website here pretty soon. The city's got a YouTube page or YouTube channel set up that all the city council and advisory board and commission meetings will be on, so that'll be easier to get to those. Instead of trying to navigate through AGP's website, we'll be posting all those things. City's Facebook page is on there, www.facebook.com/cityofmoral bay. Every department's posting three times a week, news, special events, just stuff. So keep an eye out for that. And then on the back page is my January 2015 Harbor Department update that we're now giving out to all the city council, and it also is going on the city's website. I talked about CMANC and all the things we're going out there for. A fair number of meetings with EPA as well for water issues. I know the heated back up. I think it's kind of gotten a stay of execution again, but there is the possibility that fishing boats are going to have to get an EPA water discharge permit. All boats that discharge water, commercial boats, including fishing boats, we're going to have to get an EPA discharge permit. I think that effort got fought back to where the intent was that for big ships, tankers and giant container ships to get discharge permits. It was never really intended to be little fishing boats, but the way the language was, fishing boats were getting caught up in it. So I think there's a stay on that for now, but that's one of the issues circling around the federal government. And then Corps of Engineers, they got a $48 million increase to the operations and maintenance budget, which is the budget nationwide that funds all the navigation, dredging, and other navigation projects, locks and rivers and lake stuff, levees. Unfortunately, we didn't get any here. The Los Angeles District didn't get any, but we do have $2.06 million to dredge this year. We're going back to D.C. asking for $7 million to get the rest of the harbor done. the regular channel, you know, from the entrance all the way back to the inn at Morro Bay. So we're last that was done was 2009, 2010. So we're coming up on 5 to 6 years out on that. So we're looking to get money for that. And then the city's looking at the possibility of hosting a replica of Cabrillo's ship, the San Salvador, that plied the coast here back in the, what was it, 1500s. Pretty interesting meeting we had with those folks here on January 22nd. Kind of great historical background on Cabrillo, and I didn't realize all the places he'd been and all the things he'd done and the names that are all, things are all named after him. But there's the San Diego Maritime Museum Association is building this replica of the ship, and they're going up and down the coast like the other tall ships, but they're, rather than just coming to town and doing everything with their own personnel, doing some sales and a few things and then leaving town, they're getting the community more involved, and the community basically uses it as a fundraiser for the community. The cost for the ship get covered, of course, but they've got you know, a trailer and a couple trailers that come along with the ship, and they bring out all the period costumes and everything for the community to get involved and bring the students and classes in and make it a real learning and fundraising event for the community rather than just coming and walking around the ship and leaving. So that'll be interesting. I think October was the target date for when they're trying to bring the ship up. It's due to be launched here pretty soon.
Yeah, it's due to be launched April 19th in San Diego. But yeah, I was talking to Larry the other last week, and you know, we have Harbor Fest at the beginning of October, and it was looking at a couple weeks after that. So not a definite date quite yet.
Yeah, yeah, no definite date, but October for the city being an official host city. And then I skipped a couple things. Skiff and surplus gear auction is this weekend, 12 o'clock out at the end of the Embarcadero, Dirt Extended. So if you're going down passing the power plant, instead of hooking a left and going out to the rock, keep going straight out the dirt to where the bridge is being made. And over on the right, 12 noon, we got lots of good stuff, skiffs, anchors. I think we've got a big bronze propeller, some tires. When we bought our last truck, it, you know, had pretty standard truck tires, and we upgraded them to the tires we need for the sand, so we got some pretty darn brand new tires. And just miscellaneous, you know, goodies and stuff, so come on out for that. I think Becca Kelly, the patrol supervisor, is putting it on Facebook to try and get the word out. So come on out at 12 noon. Harbor Patrol happenings on Thursday, February 19th, three teenagers decided that it was a good idea to go scale the rock, and apparently they got to the top and had a great view. Came down, somebody spotted them. One of them ended up going on that largely quarried face on the east side, kind of facing the rock and southeast a little bit, and he scrambled his way down to a sheer cliff face. It was about a 200-foot straight drop, and it was overhung. And it, fortunately, his mother was in cell phone contact with him, and police and state parks and harbor personnel were with her and told her to tell him to just stop and sit down and don't move, because he was inching his way down to the point of no return, and it was looking pretty bad there for a while because he was over a sheer cliff. So he stopped. The other two people he's with ended up climbing back up through some brush and got back up to sort of the main trail. Fire department ended up going up. It ended up going into the night, a little past sunset. They had to light the rock up. The fire department had personnel had to go down and rappel down to him and hooked onto him and pulled him up. So it was a good ending, but Lori and I were at the office spotting him with binoculars, and for a while there it was real dodgy when that kid was just hanging right above that cliff. We thought that was going to be it. So fortunately he didn't fall, but I think he's going to have a bit of a costly bill to pay because of what he did. And then the very next weekend, another couple kids went up and kind of did the same thing. I didn't think they had to be rappelled out of there, but they got in a bad way. So, you know, the rock used to be a destination that people would climb all the time. There are stairs and a path going up, but it's deteriorated. It's illegal. There's loose rock. There's poison oak everywhere. It's just not a good place to go. Enjoy it from a distance. If you want to see it from up high, rent a helicopter, an airplane or something, but it's not a good place to be. So fortunately, both of those incidents didn't result in anybody getting hurt or killed, because they could have easily gone that way. And on February 21st, finally, we had a stand-up paddler that suffered a pretty serious leg injury just south of the South Jetty surfing. I think he kind of did the splits and tore up some ligaments and whatnot in his leg, and we ended up having to jet ski him out of there. And he ended up going to the hospital for that, but got out of there and got him back out of harm's way.
Thank you, Eric. Any questions for Eric? Ron?
Eric, is the Harbor Department's need assessment that you just referred to in your report on the calendar?
On the calendar, how so?
Is it scheduled to take place?
I've got a estimated cost from RRM Design Group, who's done these things before for the city, and I'm getting ready to start working out that paperwork and get them under contract for them to get going. So it's not on the calendar right this second, but I'm moving in that direction.
Question?
Alan?
It sort of seems to me that if the city proceeds with eliminating the parking along the Embarcadero and develops the triangle lot, that it pretty much has given up on possibly using that area for a haul-out facility. And I was just wondering, I know there's a big need for parking. I was just wondering if you concurred, and since the PG&E property is no longer up for negotiation for additional sites, so what do you think of that whole?
The parking in the triangle lot that we're setting up temporary, the city, I think, needs to master plan that, and I think that's going to be part of the local coastal plan and general plan and waterfront master plan updating, is to kind of vision out. You know, if you look at the old general plan, it basically says the city is a community of retired folks with a bunch of tourists. And it was back probably in the 1970s or 80s when that was made, and things have obviously changed. And so we'll be updating the plan in general. A lot of that is dealing with the open space. So I think the master planning of that in the longer term will come from the general plan update and local coastal plan update. I don't think that... I mean, the promenade idea, we'll see where the council goes with it, what kind of priority they set on when we go to budgeting. So basically, we've taken all the priorities and goals and objectives from the city council, attaching a dollar figure to them, and then during budget time, we basically bring that to the council and see which items they want to fund and which they don't. Promenade may be one. Promenade may not. We'll see where the council goes with that. But even if we move forward with that, I don't think that using that lot for some parking, I don't think it entirely precludes still consideration for boatyard. I think the city's well aware, and the boatyard's a goal is equal to or greater than the promenade idea. So, you know, if it comes down to decision, well, promenade parking or boatyard, I think the city's going to grapple with that. Council will have to grapple with that and figure out what priority use it wants to use. But no, I don't think it'll. It's definitely not off the table, I don't think, for consideration, and that pursuing that promenade doesn't just axe the idea that it's a possible spot for a boatyard.
I just wanted to shine a light on it, is all.
Thank you. Any other questions? Okay.
I'll make one comment.
Yeah, Dana.
Since Alan shined a light on that, yeah, I was thinking back in the beginning of the staff report about cutting the wall down. I thought, wow, if you had a haul-out facility, boatyard there, you'd want that wall to be there and be expensive to put back. So I just thought I'd shine the light on that.
Thank you. Okay, as we move forward here, C1, and if you could look, that was also given to you this evening, is from Port of Bellingham, Washington. This is their regulations, from what I understand. This was given to us by Ron. And we're supposed to discuss tonight five policies and pertaining to, you know, requiring vessel insurance for use of city facilities as being, I think, probably the number one issue to discuss tonight. I don't know where we're going to come to a conclusion, but this particular document gives what they require their vessels to do, and it might be good reading to look at this too as we discuss the rules and regulations. Yes, Ron.
It actually is not restricted to the Port of Bellingham, so perhaps whenever Eric feels it's appropriate, when he gets into that particular item, I'd be happy to share with the board, if they haven't already viewed it, what's in there.
Thank you. Okay, C1, Eric.
Right. So much like it seemed like that format worked at the last meeting with putting these items, I think there's six of them all together for tonight, and putting them in an order and considering what the issues are and current rules and codes and other staff information and recommendations, if any. Requiring insurance, vessel insurance for use of city facilities is pretty closely tied to insurance. Requiring insurance for liveaboards, so we'll speak to the main vessel insurance item first, and then I guess Ron, you can weigh in when I get done here with what you found. So the issue is, so these are, and I'll remind everybody and the greater public, several meetings ago we identified a slew of things under the city's harbor rules and regulations and municipal code relating to the harbor use and bay use, and just identified a number of items that the Harbor Advisory Board wished to address that we were looking at to potentially update as we go through all of our rules and regulations and municipal code. And this is off of that list. I divided them into three different groups. The first group we did last meeting was operational sort of things that, you know, dock use and time limits and those sort of things. These are more policy-type questions and policy issues. And then I think the last group is environmental issues, so we'll be seeing those in April. So the insurance use, the issue being, you know, with vessels, and we'll get to recommendations here in a second, without insurance, the city's potentially liable for damage, injuries, death, pollution from vessel accidents. One of the bigger problems we have is derelict vessels. If you've been down at the launch ramp in the last couple of days, you've seen the shillelagh there getting cut up, and that's the poster child of boats that just get abandoned and people walk away from, and now we're having to deal with it. And would insurance have possibly prevented that? We don't know. So the question for the Harbor Advisory Board is, do we want to require insurance for all folks using city facilities? A lot of private marinas and up and down the coast generally do. There's different levels of insurance. Currently, we've got nothing in our municipal code that says you do or don't have to have insurance. There's basically two types of marine insurance applicable. And Ron, I'm sure you'll weigh in with a lot more information than I have. Hull and machinery, that basically covers for loss of the vessel. It sinks, you get your vessel replaced. It burns up, you get your vessel replaced. You have a major catastrophic event, your insurance pays for it. Protection indemnity, or P&I, commonly called liability, covers for third-party liabilities arising out of the ownership of the vessel. Typically, there are two different policies. P&I will cover wreck removal and pollution and a slew of other things that potentially harm others. So that becomes a liability issue. One of the potential ways that this can head off boats like the Shillelagh and others is that, you know, insurance, not always, but insurance generally requires the vessel to be surveyed or regularly hauled out and inspected and maintained. So have vessels have that requirement, obviously there's going to be a higher degree of maintenance and oversight from an insurance standpoint, with the possibility that less vessels will deteriorate into you know, sort of derelict doom like some of them have. P&I insurance could result in less exposure to the city, but it's a cost, obviously, and with our commercial fishing fleet in particular, costs are always a sensitive issue, and what some vessels may not be insurable just because of their age and design, and I can probably point to several of those types of boats in our harbor that are perfectly good, seaworthy, operational, money-making commercial fishing boats, but they can't get insurance just because it becomes too costly because of the age and design of the boat. There's a lot of moving parts to this. I am by no means an insurance expert. I would recommend that if the Harbor Advisory Board or City want to continue looking at this, we potentially form an ad hoc committee to really start looking at the different issues and get our commercial fishermen on board and talk to them and really investigate it further to see what the issues are and aren't, and really take a hard look at it and not rush into anything, because it's a pretty serious issue and potential a lot of costs. So, Ron, anything you want to add on your handout and all the things you brought?
Well, the handout is in the process of this review, the regs, policy and regulations review from Morro Bay. We've accumulated a database of 21 different ports, marinas, and municipalities, their rules and regulations, some more extensive than others. And out of those 21, six of them require liability insurance. None of them, by the way, require hull coverage. And I personally, I don't see that that serves any particular purpose insofar as mitigating the city's liability is concerned. But six of them have liability insurance requirements, and this is West Coast to East Coast, of about $300,000 or more as far as a policy limit. Two of them require $500,000 or more. One of them requires $250,000 or more. One of them requires insurance but doesn't state any particular amount, which is interesting. And two of them appear to have addressed the issue with some pretty stringent liability limitation language in their moorage agreements and in their policies and procedures manuals as well. So that's just a summary of what you have there in front of you, insofar as requiring insurance for vessel use is concerned.
Okay, so, and one thing I didn't mention, and then maybe we open it up for public comment, possibly strengthening our operable and seaworthy section and to really put some teeth into that, in addition to another item on here, use of impoundment of vessels for other than non-payment of fees and impounding a vessel for not living up to an operable seaworthy standard may be another way to put some teeth into that standard to ensure better compliance. So I wanted to throw that out there rather than a blanket insurance thing. So I don't know if anybody out in the audience wants to speak to the insurance or...
Anyone in the audience have any comments? Jeremiah? 3 minutes.
Ladies and gentlemen of the Harbor Advisory Board, city staff, I spoke with Eric when they began thinking about doing this. But, one of the things I just heard, and now we've been incorporated here for 50 years, and we've had some problems in the past here with derelict boats. Apparently we continue to do so with the shillelagh in the parking lot, and I did hear the shillelagh mentioned. And I heard derelict boats mentioned. So if we want to identify what problem do we have here. So if it's identified as derelict boats and non-payment boats, then the question would be, well, if they were required to have insurance, would they be here in the parking lot? And the reality with that is it's a derelict boat. It's an abandoned boat. A person's not going to have insurance on an abandoned boat. It's an abandoned boat. So if the guy leaves his car on the side of the road, he doesn't give a damn if he's got insurance or not. It's leaving it on the side of the road. So would this solve the problem? In other words, is this the solution to the problem? And my biggest concern is I've got all kinds of insurance on our boat, so I'm not speaking for myself. I'm speaking for those people who have boats that might not be insurable. Boats that are fine boats are making a good living on them, so forth and so on, and because of the age of the boat, the class of the boat, the material, the construction material, that insurance companies are not willing to take them on. So then what do we do with those guys? Just say, oh, the hell out of here then. You can't be in Morro, you don't, can't live in Morro Bay anymore. I don't know. I mean, is it going to open up a lot more problems than we want to address to begin with? Are the guys with borderline boats going to go, I'm not going to put insurance in this boat and walk away from now? So you end up with a pile of boats right off the get-go. I don't know. It just seems to me that we've gone this far, and if the problem is identified as derelict boats, I don't think that this is the way to solve a derelict boat problem. Might be a way to solve other problems or issues, but not that particular issue.
So, thank you.
Thank you.
Hi. Hi, Bear.
Bear again.
Yes.
Paul B. policy, number six, is insurance required on liverboards? Is that going to go on liverboard SOPs?
Yeah, we're going to talk about it today.
Do we have an SOP for liverboards or standard operating procedure for any of us, or are you just going to point us out or point your finger at us or say, okay, I don't like the looks of your boat. You're going to impound my boat, my personal property, for something that you don't like?
Something you don't see?
Something you tell me is a scab and you won't give me a liverboard permit because my boat's a scab? This is actually his words to me. I bought a 40-foot home. Go ahead. Excuse me. I bought a 40-horse motor to put on my boat, right? I can get hull insurance on my boat. It's a fiberglass boat. There's no problem, with me getting liability because, it's a fiberglass boat. The point is, if I get so sick and tired of him hassling me all the time, I'd walk into my boat. What happens?
We're talking about vehicle insurance, not... This is a different matter.
It's it.
Did you have something?
Is it only for number one, or did it cover liverboard?
No, it's just for number one.
Okay, thank
that's.
You.
Thanks. Okay. With no. Other public comment here. How would we like to proceed, board here? We'd like to talk about it. Ron?
Yes, I would like to talk about it. My personal opinion is that it would, for openers, I think it's worthwhile looking into an effective limitation of the city's liability in the particular regards that we're talking about here, which is vessel use and ownership. Through limitation of liability language, and as the harbor director has suggested, also the operability and seaworthiness city regulation and policy. As I said, just as a sample, and of course there's hundreds of ports and marina and city facilities across the country, if not thousands, and out of just the 21 sample that we have, when I said 9 of the 10 of them have a liability insurance requirement. Well, that means 21 of them don't. And 2 of the others address the problem with very stringent liability limitations. So I think it's worthwhile looking into that approach as opposed to an out-of-the-box contemplating making vessel owners acquire liability insurance.
Dana?
Well, I do see a problem that, in looking at this, you're talking about insurance, having the boat surveyed. There's a lot of boats that can't be hauled here. So how are you going to survey them here? I guess you'd survey them somewhere else. But, that's one issue. I'm kind of looking at the ad hoc way of going about this whole thing as maybe a good avenue with representatives from liverboards, commercial fishermen. I think Lynn's been on that committee before, liverboards, and as a representative from the Harbor Advisory Board, that might work out well.
I agree. Neil?
I agree with Dan. I think this is a much larger issue that's going to need a lot more in-depth talk and input from all the shareholders in this. So I would agree to continue diving into this with an ad hoc.
Lynn?
Yeah, I have a question for Eric. In the last 10 years, how many incidences have there been that caused a problem or expense to the city and would have been solved by requiring the liability insurance?
Off the top of my head.
Now, this isn't derelict boats that need destruction. This is other things.
Well, off the top of my head, you know, vessel incidents. There was, boy, the sinking of the Susan Diane,
yep,
which ended up huge pollution incident. We spent, I won't even say, six figures cleaning that up. Fortunately, Coast Guard and Fish and Game stepped in and took the lion's share of it, but we ended up with that. We've had a few other smaller vessel sinkings. We've had vessels run into the jetties and sink. You know, usually it ends up being a sinking and pollution event, although we have had some vessels that have inadvertently pumped overboard and created pollution events where we incurred costs. Where typically when something like that happens, if it triggers insurance, it triggers the insurance to come pay for folks, professionals, to come in and deal with. We've got a fishing boat or a sailboat right now that Coast Guard towed in that had taken on a bunch of water and had a ton of fuel in the bilges, and we spent a fair amount of time and energy helping him get the water out and trying to figure out how to get the fuel out, and then until he finally got his insurance to come around and help him out. But you know, it's not super common, but there, you know, the exposure is fairly large when it's a big incident with especially with a lot of fuel. I think pollution is probably the bigger cost to deal with. You know, when boats sink, you know, some of them that have sunk are, you know, derelicts that have just spiraled the drain and end up sinking.
And those
as part
are the
of the
ones
process
that wouldn't have insurance anyway.
Right. Like. Some were not derelicts. Were, you know, working boats that had an accident of one sort or another. So things have happened. Not like, you know, 10 times a year, but it occurs on a infrequent basis.
Once or twice a year.
Yeah, it's probably a fair assessment.
So about 20 times in 10 years.
Yeah.
Alan?
I like hearing all these creative approaches. As a fisherman, I didn't like being forced to get liability insurance like I was last summer in Newport. I would like to be on the committee. If there's an ad hoc committee, I'd like to try some different ideas out, some other different ideas.
And Gene?
Yeah, Eric, do we have a definition for city facilities, or are we talking about?
Yeah, good question. It would be, yeah, it's our T-piers, our slips, things that we rent directly out. I wouldn't be seeing this as, you know, applying to the moorings at Marina Square per se, the things that we rent directly out.
The city facilities that you rent out directly, not moorings that you lease to somebody else who may or may not have insurance on their boat.
I wouldn't see it as that, no.
Nor lease sites. Even though the city...
Yeah, lease sites handle their own insurance, whether they want to insure, make their boaters be insured or not.
So we have a definition for city facilities.
Yeah, our slips and our piers.
Okay.
Well, you know, the thing that I, you know, just, Gene, you brought up an interesting point. If we're going to do this for just city facilities, we're going to make the fishermen, the liverboards, usually the ones we talk about, being the only ones that are required to have insurance if that's our end result, and not let anyone else. I don't see the point where we're covering ourselves. I mean, there's still a lot of other liability issues unless that master leaseholder is going to have P&L for all the rentals. I mean, we would have to make somewhat of a blank policy for everything, every vessel. Or not, yeah, yeah, exactly. Because it just doesn't make any sense just to highlight 30 liveaboards, 70 fishermen, when we have supposedly 500 boats out there. So I think that we need to either have an ad hoc committee or discuss it a little bit more. I mean, that's my feeling.
But, Bill, we're talking about city facilities. We're not talking about private facilities. And we are advising the City Council on city facilities.
Okay. Yes, Ron.
Thank you, Gene. It's an excellent point. As it relates to pollution, because we've been talking about lots of things here, we're talking about liability insurance in terms of we haven't defined what the risks are. We've included derelict boats sort of ad hoc into that. We've included pollution into that. That's actually not the literal definition of liability insurance. Pollution is most often in marine insurance an extension of your hull coverage. It's part of the sue and labor portion of your policy. So I'm just sort of springboarding off of Gene's comment. So if this is going to be addressed by the Harbor Advisory Board, I completely agree that it would be appropriate for something like an ad hoc committee to be formed, and it ought to start with identifying what kind of risks they're going to discuss.
Okay. Dana?
Yeah, I'm just thinking about this also, and it not necessarily have to be an ad hoc, to be a subcommittee of our panel. We have pretty good representation right here.
But I thought we wanted to get some stakeholders involved that maybe.
Yeah, I just don't want to be limited if nobody shows up. Nobody, no other people want to. But it looks like we might. So maybe ad hoc would work.
Yeah, I think maybe. So do we want to form an official ad hoc committee? Would anyone like to make a recommendation on doing that? Would that be for just policy number one in dealing with just insurance, or some other matters here that might be a little bit more challenging for us?
Yeah, Neil. So in this language, just under one, it also brings up Eric quoted teeth for operability and seaworthiness. Would that be under this same committee to look at that as well? And by definition of teeth, and just for people, what do you refer to?
The point of that paragraph, I think, was putting some teeth into the operable and seaworthiness standard may be an alternative to requiring insurance. In other words, it might be just as an effective tool to kind of head off some of these things we've been trying to head off. So no, I don't think if we do an ad hoc committee, my thought was it's to look at insurance only. We, you know, the other insurance issue we've got here is insurance for liveaboards, which as you see on page 4 of the staff report, it got pretty short because I kind of deferred to, well, there's a lot more moving parts here and a lot more stakeholders that need to weigh in and could weigh in and get us a better discussion and potential output. And I figured if we went in that direction, the liveaboard insurance issue would be wrapped up in that same committee. So, but no, the teeth and the operable and seaworthiness, and like I said, the teeth could be impoundment. Teeth could be, you know, other fines or things that compel people to keep their boats maintained and not let them deteriorate in the first place.
Ron?
Eric, correct me, please, if I'm wrong, but wasn't the point of this, conceptually, the point of this particular item, and I don't mean item just number one, to address, to the extent that the Harbor Advisory Board is capable of addressing it, the issue of potential liability for the city of Morro Bay from vessel use and on the bay, was that not the concept, or did I misunderstand?
No, I don't think you misunderstood. It's liability and exposures and minimizing the city's liability and exposures due to vessel use of our facilities. No, I don't think you're misunderstood.
You know, one of the things as I was thinking about this, you know, and Jeremiah brought up an interesting point. It's been 50 years that we haven't required any insurance. And for us tonight to say yes or no, I think would be pretty shallow on our parts.
and I'm not so sure very fair. We never told any of the stakeholders that they had to have insurance, and now all of a sudden to come out with a dictate that this is going to happen, I just don't take it. I mean, I don't think it's a good way of doing it, to be honest with you. That's my opinion.
Well, Mr. Chairman, we're not a policy-setting body. So even if the Harbor Advisory Board in some majority decided it wanted to go that direction, that's not something that we're empowered to do. We would simply make a recommendation to the City Council for which we serve. But I'm a little distressed that we keep talking about insurance. That's why I asked Eric the question I just did. The topic is there some, what are there effective means, irrespective of what they might be, to try to mitigate the city's liability risk relative to the vessels on the harbor? And there's any number of possibilities, insurance potentially being one of them, but there's any number of possibilities.
What I'm trying to understand is that if you write in language to, you know, in a rules and regulations as opposed to insurance, means that if you get in an accident or you pollute, hopefully the insurance carrier is going to reimburse the city for the damages. If you have it in the rules and regulations that the city is not held liable for any of those, and if the person can't pay it, I mean, it's pointless. I mean, you know, it's just like, I don't see the point. That's what insurance is all about. I mean, we either do insurance or don't do insurance. We could put language, but I just don't see how it would work, personally.
Alan.
I would like, if there was an ad hoc committee formed, I would like it to have creative license to look at all kinds of possibilities, like Ron says, ways to mitigate the city's exposure by decreasing the incidence of occurrence as opposed to just, you know, paying for it ahead of time by getting insurance. I mean, I think there's been several ideas brought up tonight that seemed like they had a lot of potential. The insurance was one of them. It's escaping me now.
What? Eric's teeth.
Yeah, increasing the seaworthiness standard. Ron had another one, but I was kind of excited. I thought, you know, those are good ideas, good alternatives, and I'd like to explore them more, but not just be limited to insurance.
Okay. Would anyone like to make a motion then to form an ad hoc committee?
I'll move that we form an ad hoc committee to look at the ways to deal with the city's liability with vessels on the bay.
Do I hear a second?
Particularly items 1 and 6 in the staff report.
Alan? Pardon me?
I was just going to say, and is the intent to not limit it to insurance? Are we going to call it a risk management ad hoc committee or something along those lines?
Yeah, I guess that would work. I was just
okay. Risk management. Would you like to repeat that, please?
Okay, I would move that we create an ad hoc committee for the risk management of the liability of our vessels in the harbor to the city. No, I would like it to go beyond that. I'm talking about specifically item in. In C1, there's 1 and 6. It's also the liveaboards. They might as well be looking at both at the same time rather than having two separate committees.
I agree. Alan, do I still hear your second?
Yes, I second the motion.
Okay. All in favor? Oh, I'm sorry. Is there any discussion? I apologize, Ron. Discussion, Ron?
No.
Oh, Gene?
Yeah, if you want to limit it to items number 1 and 6, that's fine. But to open it up to the whole everybody in the harbor, that's a different issue. So I think your motion should just address liveaboards and city facilities.
That would be correct. That would be correct. I stated 1 and 6 in the staff report.
Okay, I stand corrected. The ad hoc committee will be for items number 1 and 6 in the staff report. Alan, do you concur?
I'd like to get some input from the harbor director. What do you think about all this? I mean, is Gene right? We don't have any jurisdiction over the harbor entire?
That would be a question at this point, I couldn't add. It's probably an answer the city attorney would need to be, or a question the city attorney need to be asked. Yeah, does the city have jurisdiction over, let's say, the boats? I mean, we do through, and I'll use Marina Square because it's, you know, large and well-known. If the city enacted some sort of blanket insurance requirement, would it apply to the vessels renting at Marina Square? Well, Marina Square is required to have insurance, and if their lease doesn't say that vessels shall carry some sort of insurance, we can't force that leaseholder to force that upon their subtenant slip holders. Could that apply to them outside of the lease? Sounds like a question for the city attorney.
Well, now, what about the boat that runs into the breakwater? And does that fall under your jurisdiction, no matter where he comes from?
That's a good point, in the harbor in general. You know, something runs into the floating dock, something runs in the sands pit, and it's not using city facilities per se. I mean, I guess you could consider the whole harbor a city facility, but if it's not on the piers or slips, it's a good question because, like say, breakwater or channel or elsewhere other than physically tying up on our facilities.
I've been reading a great volume of stuff here in preparation for the meeting, and it seems like somewhere I saw that the Harbor Patrol has some greater authority for vessels using the navigable ways. And I can't remember what exactly makes me think that, but it's out there. Maybe you can.
No, we do have the City of Morro Bay Harbor Department, and our rules and regulations do apply to the overall bay in general. The question that I would have, would we have that sort of regulatory authority over a vessel that's renting from somebody else? Well, yeah, it's in the waters of Morro Bay, but they're operating under an agreement of an existing leaseholder. That one I don't know the answer to.
Do all your leaseholders have to have insurance, Eric?
Yeah, the master leaseholders do, and all our sub-lessees do. But typically in the master leases, they don't call out for insurance for slip holders. And slip holders are not required to get subleases. You know, a unit, you know, somebody comes into Marina Square and rents unit, you know, B, they've got to be insured. Where if somebody comes in and rents slip 25, no, they're not a sublessee by definition of the lease, so they don't fall under those requirements. That master leasee may require it of them just for his business practices, but it doesn't fall under the lease.
Excuse me.
Alan.
If they have an accident at this hypothetical private, who ends up paying for it then if there's pollution?
It'd be the master leaseholder, right?
Or in the past, who has ended up paying?
Yeah, if somebody has an accident at Marina Square, let's say a boater, you know, has a pollution. I mean, obviously, we're going to respond to any pollution event. Whether or not they require insurance or not, I don't know. But if there's some sort of a damage or physical damage to the facility, or an injury or death as a result of one of their slip holders using that facility, it's going to come under the master, or if it's under a sublease, it's going to come under the lease's insurance.
Well, I'm talking about, I mean, in my mind, I'm thinking pollution costs is the big one. And that's not damage to the facility or, you know.
Again, this may be a legal question. If somebody, let's say somebody sinks at Marina Square, and I hate to keep picking on Marina Square, but I do. let's say something sinks at Marina Square. Who's going to raise it? Who cleans up the pollution? Who pays for that? We're going to make an initial response, but we, the city, are going to be looking for the master tenant to take care of dealing with that problem because it's one of their slip holes. Even though it's not a sub-lessee where it's required to have insurance, maybe they do, maybe they don't, we're going to be looking at the master leaseholder to cover that event because they're the ones that are renting to that person and they're the ones that name the city additionally insured. So we would be getting covered by the insurance under that umbrella.
Well, based on that, I would say maybe we'd be safe to just look at the city's operation.
And that's within the lease site. Let's say that slip holder's out in the channel or he's going out to the harbor mouth and he sinks out in the harbor mouth and has a pollution event and the boat needs to be raised. Now the master leaseholder's insurance, I would assume, is not going to cover it because he's outside of the lease and he's not using the leasehold anymore. This is only within the lease premises, which...
Well, that's a separate issue. Ron?
This discussion is going exactly where it ought to go. It's a very complex, very involved, and not simple matter. So my thinking is that if the Harbor Advisory Board is going to take this on, that it might consider doing it initially in quite a general way. And if it forms an ad hoc committee, clearly from this discussion, it wouldn't be very long before the ad hoc committee would need the advice of council, city council. It would also benefit from the advice from a qualified marine insurance agent, for instance. So if there's any agreement to that conceptually, then I would suggest that the existing motion be withdrawn and be restated in more general terms if the Harbor Advisory Board is going to take this on.
Lori, could you read the motion right now as it's stated?
Yeah, I'll help.
I'm sorry.
I think the motion was for an ad hoc committee to look at the name of the committee was a liability risk management committee. Dana made the motion and Alan made the second to look at city facilities and liveaboards.
So do we want to broaden that?
So Ron, you're saying that as we should just put this on our agenda for a little longer and then think about...
No. If the board wants to form an ad hoc committee and take this on, fine. But I think what's going to happen is if you restrict your scope, for instance, to, and I'm not singling them out, let's just suppose liveaboards, it isn't going to be very long before the committee is going to be tripping over all sorts of other issues that might impede its ability to be effective addressing just one.
Yeah, Lynn?
So, in your opinion, this has so many ramifications into other topics that really we cannot possibly deal with it here unless we simply reject the idea of insurance. That we, just to explore it and find out what our limits are or may be, we have to... We're almost forced into an ad hoc committee.
Is that a question or a statement?
That's a question.
Well, if a majority of
Well, it's not directly a question to you, Ron. It's I'm forming a question in my head for the board. If we want to pursue this topic, then really the only reasonable way it seems to pursue it is to form a committee. If that committee meets once or twice or three times and decides that our recommendation is forget about insurance and leave risk management to city council, that could be what they come up with. But just from the number of issues that have been raised during this discussion, it seems that it is a topic that is beyond what we should be doing here on camera in this meeting.
Okay. So...
Which says that we should be forming the ad hoc committee and let it go where it may.
All right, Dana? Oh, Alan?
I just wanted to bring one more topic up before we drop the discussion. In your research, have you ever come across a city that got a blanket liability policy? In other words, and this is my own idea, but it just seems like a city ought to be able to insure itself against this kind of thing. If any wreck happens, any pollution, anything happens within the city, then the city pays an annual fee and the insurance company covers them. Now, I realize that's really a different approach, but I'm just wondering if you ever saw anything like that.
Yes, some of port authorities do that. Anybody can buy one of the realities of life is anybody can buy insurance for anything if you're willing to pay for it.
In the city, well, I think that's a good thing to look at then in the ad hoc committee, to be honest with you. That's a good idea.
And the city does have a blanket insurance.
Yeah, I mean, I have a
for all of our facilities.
I mean,
we're insured.
Yeah.
But like a car accident, if I get in a car accident, it's somebody else's fault. You know, my insurance is going to cover, but they're going to go after that person's insurance because they're at fault and recoup their losses and have the insurance company pay for it. Same thing with the city. If somebody has an accident, and I thought of a couple more, Lynn, with some boat damages that have been done. If someone has an accident and smashes our dock, yeah, generally our insurance will cover it, but they're going to go after the boat owner and the boat owner's insurance if they have it because if they're at fault. So,
okay,
but we already do have insurance.
Let's go down the row here again. Do we have any other questions? Because if we're going to deal with anything else, if we're going to put the risk management and an ad hoc committee, let's decide whether or not we're going to do that or not. Okay? Yeah. I call a question. So basically, all in favor of forming an ad hoc committee, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
Opposed.
Okay. So we have 6-1. So the ad hoc committee is formed. Now, how is this ad hoc committee going to be comprised? Now, I see one volunteer, Dana. No? Alan? Ron? Okay. And then... Denise?
Mr. Chairman, I would suggest that you give yourself a little time to form your committee. I think that you might want to reach out. It would be appropriate, I suspect, to have the chair of the committee perhaps sit on the board, whoever that might be,
okay. And
then you could charge them with reaching out into the various stakeholders to get some participation.
All right, so basically right now, we'll put this on the table and see if we can get some. Should we appoint a chairman then? Alan, would you like to be the chairman of this?
No.
Okay. Okay.
Are we taking nominations?
No. Gene? Alan?
No.
Lynn? Like to be the chair of the ad hoc committee? Okay. Thanks, Lynn. So we'll have you'll reach out to, well, okay. All right, then. So let's get back on the agenda then. If we're going to form the ad hoc committee for 1 and 6, yes, sir.
Mr. Harbor Director, by what is there any time limit in your process by which you would like this committee to try to conclude its work, whatever that might be?
Not in particular. I think once we get to the next grouping of items to address at the next meeting, I'll be going back into my cave and rewriting and scribbling and coming up with some language, and eventually we bring that back. So by the time we bring back the overall changes with language and hopefully Harbor Advisory Board recommendation of approval, so just keep within that timeline, which I suspect is going to be, this is March, April, you know, early summer. So I think make sure it doesn't go longer than that larger process, which is going to be a work in progress.
60, 90, or 120?
I'm going to say 120. Get the maximum amount of time possible.
Okay, Lynn, you'll work with Eric, form a committee, meet, report back to us. Sounds good to me. Okay, Eric, let's go on to number three.
So we covered one and six. That's good. We got the six out of the way. Item three, use of impoundment for vessels other than non-payment of fees. Currently, the municipal code, section 15.56, which I think is attached to the staff report somewhere in there, outlines the process by which if people don't pay their fees, we can impound their boat, and eventually we can sell it at a lien sale, either through the state of California or through the federal government, the documentation process. The rules and regulations, so the issue being, we have authority to impound vessels under 1556, but it's only for non-payment of fees. There's other instances, safety and security, threat to pollute, where it would be advantageous to be able to impound a vessel, again, to put more teeth into our rules and regulations to get compliance with folks that aren't compliant by impounding their vessel and basically seizing it until they stop doing whatever they're not supposed to be doing, or the reverse. The rules and regulations, as you look in the current rule and code section, addresses non-payment of fees. Our rules and regulations, paragraph 2 of section 5 says impoundment for a vessel can be impounded for continued use of city facilities if without permission. So if somebody continues to use city facilities without permission, the rules and regulations say we can impound, but the impoundment section that it refers to, which is 15.56, doesn't address that, so they're really not in concert with each other. So that would need to be corrected. So what we're recommending is that the municipal code be revised and the rules and regulations to match so that we can use impoundment for things other than non-payment of fees. Like I say, threat to safety and security, a vessel represents a threat to pollute, an owner that constantly, you know, abuses time limits or other things, overstaying in the anchorage, those sorts of things. Impoundment being another tool in the toolbox to get compliance of that.
Yeah, Dana?
Yeah, Eric. As far as the shillelagh, I think you've had an ongoing couple of years dealing with that, and this kind of congruity with the codes would have helped that along. Is that kind of fall under that?
Yeah, potentially could have in hindsight, had we been able to impound the vessel. And that one probably would have fallen under operable and seaworthy, and threat to pollute and threat to safety and security, because the boat certainly did have several pollution events and it was not well maintained, and impoundment of that vessel back in, you know, many years past possibly could have forced better compliance in that particular case.
Neil?
What's your current legal authority for repeat polluters as it stands now? When somebody's constantly having multiple issues, what are you guys currently allowed to do?
We've got the administrative citation process, which is a $100 fine first time, $200 second, and I think $300 or $500 for third and subsequent. If something doesn't get corrected through the administrative citation process, so somebody, you know, if they pollute and they pay the fine, and they can pollute again and pay the fine, and they can pollute again and pay the fine. Ultimately, something like that could be turned over to the city attorney for turning over to the district attorney for prosecution under a civil or criminal act. Most things don't generally get to that level. It's a whole other legal level of effort to make that happen. But currently, it's an administrative citation process. Typically, we're the teeth, quote-unquote, since it's an overused term we're using tonight, I'll keep using it, the real teeth in any kind of pollution event is more typically Fish and Game and Coast Guard. When Coast Guard comes in and starts showing a federal interest and Fish and Game comes in, they generally bring a little heavier hammer.
So the reason I ask is, you have the language as threat to pollute, but you also have, whether or not we decide on the side, but would it also be possible to include language that would include key defenders that are already...
Sorry. I could hear myself loud in my head. Sorry. I'll repeat that. You already have the language here, threat to pollute, is. But would it be helpful to also have the language to include repeat offenders that you guys already have on record as continuing to pollute on an ongoing basis?
Yeah, I think pollution, if somebody is polluting, I mean, that they're not allowed to do that under current rules and regulations. Like I say, the threat to pollute is, I mean, yeah, possibly someone has polluted, and, you know, they've pumped overboard once or twice or three times, and we deem them a continued threat, you know, whether we've cited them or not, but the problem that caused the pollution in the first place isn't being corrected. Yes, impoundment is a tool to get control of that boat and achieve compliance would definitely be something that would be helpful. That answer your question?
Yeah.
I have a question. In every harbor I've been in, if things go wrong, you're worried about the Coast Guard coming. Those are the guys that respond to pollution events that, as you say, bring the heavy hammer. I don't understand why the Harbor Patrol, I mean, isn't it their job to contact the Coast Guard if there's pollution?
Not the harbor.
Yeah, if there is an actual pollution on the water event, yes, we do contact Coast Guard and Fish and Game. Typically, because Coast Guard, we've got them right here in the harbor, we get the local guys and the Santa Barbara guys will come up if it's significant enough for them to come and take care of it or deal with it, depending on the nature of it. But they already are, they do have jurisdiction, and they do respond to those events concurrently, yes.
Oh, okay, for the benefit of everybody's understanding, are you referring to like smaller events that could possibly be handled by the Harbor Patrol without involving the Coast Guard? And because when the Coast Guard comes, we're not talking $100 or $200. Right. And he was talking about pollution, and he's asking for impoundment privileges of boats that are possibly repeat polluters.
And or a threat to pollute, in which, to me, a threat to pollute is can cover a wide range of things, from a boat that's, you know, potentially sinking or is sinking, that takes continuous pumping, that we know has got fuel on board, and other hazardous or other materials on board, engine full of oil, and it takes extraordinary measures just to keep it afloat. I mean, that's a threat to pollute. Somebody that does fuel in their bilge and they are pumping overboard, obviously that's an issue in and of itself, or they've got fuel in the bilges and aren't taking care of it, another threat to pollute. So it's not just purely somebody that's pumped oil overboard, it's other potential issues of boats, you know, sinking and taking on water.
I think we have, is this a good time for public comment right now on this particular matter? I got one more question.
Okay.
Dana?
Yeah, so if a boat's impounded by the city, what happens then? I mean, what kind of fees and how do you get your boat back? Just
Impoundment fees, I don't have off the top of my head, but and how you get your boat back is you fix the problem.
Okay, just ask.
Neil?
To add to your list of, you were just running down threats to pollute, besides boat sinking and fuel, there's also human waste, which I think is important to notice as well in the discussion for pollution.
Thank you. Would there be any public comment?
Thank you, Board. Drew Jacobson, Morro Bay. I think we should move slowly on this. This is private property that is owned by individuals. And I understand the idea of pollution or pumping overboard, that sort of thing, but that's not, I think what Eric is talking about is an open-ended. If there is an issue, it seems to me that there's no limitation on this. It's whatever the Harbor Department feels it should be confiscated can be confiscated. For example, Neil, you own the oyster farm. There's a problem with you. You're arguing with me. I'm the harbor director. And if there is that, no limitations on what I can do, then I'm going to confiscate your oyster farm, as an example. I think we need to be very careful on this. There are vessel liens, but those are actually procedures that are set up by the state. I believe that's what Eric is talking about. If I owe money to the city, they can put a lien on my boat. This is totally different than what we're talking about now. A lien is a process. It's run through the state, and it allows me, as the boat owner, to have my due process, to be able to take this and dispute perhaps what that other, if the other individual is asking money of me. This has none of that. I'm very concerned about the process of this. Will that individual, and the procedures, how will this happen? For example, will Eric write a letter to me, or to Lynn, let's say she has a boat, saying you're not up on this, we feel that your boat is not seaworthy and we're going to take your boat? And what process does Lynn have to come back and have her due process to be able to dispute it? That's my concern. That,
well, you know, speaking to that, there is a there's an appeal process here that we're going to discuss in a couple other comments, so maybe we can tie it all together.
Put that in. That sounds good. Thank
Thanks,
you.
Thanks, Drew. Denise?
Hi, I'm Denise Jacobson from Morro Bay. I have to agree with my husband, Drew. I'm very concerned about this, and I don't know if this has anything to do with liveaboards. It usually does. If somebody doesn't have their permit, if they are going to confiscate that boat, I have been in meetings where the harbor director and the supervisor has said, if people don't make enough money, they shouldn't live on their boats. And one was stated that they would not be happy until those people were homeless. So my concern is that this is sort of an inward way to take people's boats if they don't have their permit or if the Harbor Department doesn't feel that it looks nice and that they make enough money. Thank you.
Any others? Okay, Ron?
Eric lists, I should say staff, because it's not just Eric, in the recommendations, there are three additional suggested conditions that would trigger impoundment, in addition to non-payment of fees, which is the existing regulations, existing ordinance. Is it an ordinance, Eric? or a policy?
No, it's in the municipal code.
Okay, all right. So it's all right. So it's a court ordinance. The one that certainly rings bells with me is, quote, the vessel and or vessel owner represents a threat to the safety and security of city facilities and or harbor users. That one certainly resonates with me. I, to a degree, share the concerns of, from public comment that, but I'll put it in a little different terms, and that is that I think that code that addresses impoundment needs to be quite specific for everybody's purposes. I mean, the city's, the boat owners, the public's, everybody's purpose. So I would support a motion in support of the staff recommendation to add to the existing code. The vessel and or vessel owner represents a threat to the safety and security of city facilities and or harbor users.
Dana?
Yeah, I would agree that we definitely want to have this very well written to specify exactly what we're doing so that there isn't this ambiguity that you can just make up something or whatever. But not that that would happen. I would just agree with what Ron said about specifics.
Neil?
Yeah, I concur with public comment. That is a concern. And I think that... Sorry, guys. I'll repeat that. I agree with the public comment that I think it's important to have specifics involved and know what would be laid out.
And I also concur, and keep in mind, Drew and Denise, that these are recommendations that we're making, and we're going to come back with a formal thing. Then it goes to City Council, so this isn't the last hurrah here. Lynn?
Yes, I can understand their concern. I would have it as well. I think when you say threat to pollute, it's hard to judge what a threat is that is subject to interpretation. Abuses of use or time restrictions, I think I would like to have a little more information about what has happened that would cause it to be used under that phrase. Threat to safety and security, I think that's probably fairly clear to most of us. So having it well defined, I agree, is very important, but I would like to have some information about people or how abuses of use and time restrictions have played a part and why that was included.
I guess that's me.
Yeah, Eric.
So I'll answer some of Drew and Denise's concerns. I certainly hope it didn't come across that through the staff report, I certainly did not intend or foresee this as being a blanket clause, excuse me, for the Harbor Department to use if we see something we don't like to just be able to impound it for anything and everything. The intent is for very specific reasons, chronic reasons, serious reasons, imminent threats, abuse of city time limits and those sort of things. Somebody that won't leave the anchorage. There's a 30-day limit in any 6-month period there, and folks that just refuse to leave the anchorage. Sometimes they pay their bills, sometimes they don't, which brings in the potential of a lien. But some folks just absolutely refuse to leave the anchorage. So things like that. But I agree, it needs to be specific and not just be a carte blanche, and nor did I intend it to be a carte blanche for just anything we don't like. We don't like the color of your boat, so we're going to impound it. Absolutely not. No, it would be threats and definitely a process by which we would follow and not just be out of the blue. And as you said earlier, Bill, we're looking at appeals process as well. So decisions like that, the decision to impound a vessel would be something that I would see coming under an appeals process if somebody so choose to appeal something like that.
Okay.
Alan?
Real quick, I would, if there was such a thing enacted, I would like to see the wording that as a method of last resort being coupled with it.
Gene?
Yeah, all of the above. Process and appeals, big concern. Taking without compensation. All these things kind of mix into here. So.
Ron? Oh, Lynn, I'm sorry.
Yeah, another slightly off the topic, or on the topic of impoundment, but not uses or abuses of the power to do so. What about impounding documented vessels? Would you be able to do that? I mean, you cannot simply take a vessel and put a lien on it with a documented vessel the way you can with a state registry. So what problems would ensue under that
impoundment circumstance? Impoundment and perfecting a lien are two different actions. Perfecting a lien means collecting on the lien and getting your money by seizing the boat and selling it at auction. State and federal processes differ quite a bit, obviously. So impoundment is not, if we were to impound a vessel for whatever reason, whether it's, and I'll use the O fees, which is the thing we've got in there now, which is the pretty standard clause all harbors have. If we impound for non-payment of fees, doing the actual collection of those fees is the lien process, which is still valid and still has to take place. Impoundment doesn't bypass that system.
So you could just as easily impound a documented vessel without any...
Correct. If that vessel owes money and I'm going to try and collect via a lien process, then I've got to go through the federal lien process. Correct.
Another question. How often do you impound? How often in the last 5 years have you had to do this?
It's not often. Maybe I'll turn to Lori. She deals with all the lien sales. we do. For non-payment of fees is the vast majority of boats that we impound for. We've probably done what? This so far this year, two or three maybe already?
Probably three.
Yeah, and those are the non-payment of fees. Those are pretty straightforward, pretty defined process that we go through, and the Muni Code covers it, and that's not necessarily exactly what we're addressing here.
Right.
We've already got that. I wouldn't propose that be changed. That's the way it is and should stay the way it is.
Gene?
Yeah, here again, maybe a definition of what impoundment means. Is it basically just putting a chain and a lock on the boat? That's how I see it at this point, not taking.
Yeah, it's not gaining ownership of the vessel. That's, again, for us to gain ownership of a vessel resulting out of an impoundment. If we were to impound somebody for safety and security or a threat to pollute, there's no fees. I mean, there's impoundment fees, but provided the person pays those and takes care of the problem and gets the boat out of impoundment jail, there's no fees associated with that, so we wouldn't be going after a lien sale because we're not impounding it for non-payment of fees.
Just a comment. Impoundment, I believe, is defined under 1556.020.
Okay. Thank you, Lynn. Ron?
Eric, would you be willing to bring a somewhat revised recommendation for this particular item back to the Harbor Advisory Board for the next meeting? And if you agreed to do that, does that interfere on a time basis with your process?
No. So further define this from public comment and your comments and everything else?
Yeah, on especially on
home in on
procedures,
it. Yeah,
appeals, yeah. And so forth.
No, that doesn't. It just
A little different. I mean, sometimes you take our feedback and quite correctly you just move on. I mean, you folks internalize it and you do what you do. In this particular case, I at least would like to see this brought, this particular recommendation brought back to the board.
I mean, we can bring it back to the next round. Doesn't fit the category, but that's fine. The intent of the end result of all these categories and muni code and definition, all this stuff, as you know, is eventually we bring it back as a big package, have a final Harbor Advisory Board review, hopefully pass muster on it, maybe we change a few things, and then move it on to the City Council. So it would be coming back anyhow. But yeah, it's, there's no reason I can't bring it back next time as an add-on to the last group to bring it back to further home in on it.
Okay. So we move. What's our next one, Eric? 11. Specific reference to city slips for owners, crews, guests only.
Yeah, I think this one might have come from Alan, but there's really nothing in our municipal code or rules or regulations that say our slips are for vessel owners only. Someday we may get gate access control, but until we do, we do tend to get a fair amount of the public down on our city slips, you know, fishing and whatnot. And while we've had signage, which helps some, we've never had any code to really back it up, so it just becomes a warn and advise thing. So I think the advisory board is interested in looking at formalizing that the slips are for slip holders only, and in the case of our other slips that serve on the backside as spots for tenders for the moorings, obviously those folks need access too, so it would be an allowance, continued allowance of that. We wouldn't obviously restrict that because they need to use it, and that's what those head floats are for. So, but putting in the rules and regulations, and we're recommending that we codify it officially, and then we can redo signage and puts a little bit more, again, my overused word, teeth in it.
Yes, Alan.
I spoke to at least one member of the Morro Bay Commercial Fishermen's Organization who said he liked to talk to tourists and felt it was the only way to educate him about fisheries issues. And I talked with him a little bit, and we decided that maybe we would like to see some alternative there, such as or upon invitation. You know, that you could come down the dock if you were invited on the dock by the a slip holder.
And I think that could be construed as being a guest.
How is that not a guest?
Yes.
Because it's somebody you never met before is the only
thing.
It could
still
be a guest.
Yeah, okay.
And if and for folks that, you know, and, you know, Jeremiah here may be thinking this and some others, for folks that sell off their boats, obviously we don't want to impinge upon that, and those are, you know, considered guests. I mean, yeah, you don't know them, but so yeah, if the fisherman runs into somebody they want to invite down and show them the boat and gear,
they become a guest.
I think they become a guest. Yeah, okay. That's reasonable.
Ron,
Eric, what would the nature of the quote restriction unquote be, and how would it be enforced?
It's in terms of the nature of it. It's just it's. They're, the slips are for crew owners and guests only, and not for the general public, where I think, you know, some in the general public may think that the because it's not really very well signed and we don't have any way of enforcing it, some of the members of the public think they can go walk on down. And in most cases, they're harmless, but some folks are down there for other reasons. It becomes something we can cite on if need be. I don't anticipate we're going to go on some citation frenzy. But at least we've got the ability to, and again, it comes down to the teeth. You know, you've got to be able to follow through on something to, and have the threat of it to gain compliance for it. So it ultimately becomes a citation issue.
Excuse me?
Yeah, Alan?
Yeah, there was some wording in here to the effect that it was kind of set up for in the future if we wanted to go to security gates, keyed access, whatever it might be. I just wanted to mention that when I go to other ports, what I see is they have security, they have gates, you can't get in. And when you go north to different fishing ports, what you typically see is the gates are open all day long and people are tolerated to go down, look at the boats, enjoy themselves. And at night, the gates are shut and the fishermen are careful to make sure they stay shut. to me, that sort of seems like the kind of the end result of something like this. Maybe someday we might get there or have to go there. But still leave them open during the daytime.
Dana?
Yeah, I see where staff's coming from. There's nothing currently in their code, and there could be problems that could arise. You could have people just camping out on slips, and you try to tell them that they got to leave, and they go, I don't have to leave. This is public property or whatever. You know, they just, there needs to be something in the code so that they have a way to enforce this. And you're looking at, we're talking about liability and insurance for the city. Well, here we're taking care of some of that. So I see it as a good recommendation.
Gene?
Oh, I hate to throw water on you guys. I'm involved in several designs, docks for slips up and down the waterfront here. And the Coastal Commission, they're very adamant lately that all public docks or all new construction are open to the public 24 hours a day. 24 hours a day. I would like to see the regulation go forward. I just think we're going to butt heads with the Coastal Commission later on.
Well, yeah, I know that the landing, they have coastal access there. Because when we were putting on the regatta, the collegiate regatta, I told kids, do not go over there in those slips. And sure enough, because there were some kids that parked their boats there, they said, oh, no, this guy said we could park here. This is his spot. And then I talked to a club member who was on the end of the intake, and he goes, it says coastal access right there at the beginning of the dock. But we're talking about city docks, and I don't know that that's a necessity. I mean, that's if same thing with Marina Square.
I'm stepping in here again, that we're in the process now of rebuilding our docks. When we go through that coastal use permit, that's going to be one of those conditions they're going to say is that those slips are available to the public. Now, whether you can get it to be 24 hours a day, I know we're arguing with them at this point, and I hope we can win, but I would keep your heads up.
Yeah, Gene is correct. The Morro Bay Landing, GAFCO, the Coastal Commission now recently on all these new dock permits that have come through, and I'll withhold judgment just because I'll get all bound up. But Coastal Commission has been requiring public access to the head floats. They've been able to hold it at the head float and not to the finger, but, in a practical sense, somebody walks down, they're going to go walk out to the finger because they want to see the boat, and it's going to be a problem because it's, now you're inviting the public down, and, one of the reasons for enacting a restriction just for slip holders and people that should be there is not just for security, but it's safety, and you don't just want the general public wandering around on docks because they're, with no railings, no nothing else, it's not a good place for the public to be walking around, and it's going to create problems, and it's going to be interesting if when we go to get permits to rebuild some of our slips, if Coastal starts throwing it on there as a permit condition.
Well, I'm going to abuse my spot here for a moment as this public forum and communicate directly to the Coastal Commission and every commissioner that sits on it. I would invite you to contemplate accepting personal liability for your reported position. And I would invite you to come down and accept financial responsibility for my vessel and all the other vessels that are sitting on those docks.
I second that statement.
Okay. So what do we want to do, guys, on this one? We have a motion here. Gene?
I'll make a motion that we approve the staff recommendation.
I second.
Okay, we have a first and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Okay, motion passes. Thank you. Number 15.
We've got a section in the rules and regulations. I think Gene requested this. There was a couple of floating docks in town that went away in the past. The requirement, when those went away, The city, for whatever reason, wished to get rid of those floating docks. The existing dock owners were able to basically create two moorings out of the docks that came out, but it got written into the rules and regulations that the second mooring, or one of the moorings, and we eventually assigned a number to it because it got a new mooring number, the second mooring that was created could never be sold, transferred to another party, and if the owner no longer wished to use them, they would be removed. And the rules and regulations specify or call out Associated Pacific Constructors because they were one of the entities that owned one of those floating docks, and Jim Entwistle. So the idea being we don't really need to call out those particular entities in our rules and regulations. The stipulation will remain on those two moorings, whether it needs to be in the regulations or not, I guess is maybe the question. But that's where we wrote it in, to ensure that in perpetuity the institutional knowledge would remain, so that if those folks wanted to sell the second mooring, they would not be able to.
Alan?
Do you know why that stipulation was put on there?
No, and I see Jim out here in the audience. He may know. No, I don't. No, I think probably my guess is because by creating a new mooring, and especially with the way mooring prices have gone lately, you've given two individuals basically some way of profiting off of public property that everybody else didn't have the ability to do. So the idea being, we're not going to let them sell them and make a bunch of money on them, that if they want to stop, they ever want cease to use them, they go away. So that's probably why, so they couldn't profit on the use of public property.
Okay, well, we were just talking about moorings last time, and I was informed that each mooring has, what, 100-foot square, 100-foot by 100-foot square that it occupies. Is that right?
Theoretically.
So
when these moorings were split off the dock, were new squares created for them, or they were extended out into land that previously wasn't in the mooring area?
If you look at the mooring field maps that we have, they're all gridded out and into 100-foot squares, and there's more squares than actual moorings. But, you know, like Gene says, in theory, every mooring's got a 100-foot square. They've morphed over the years, and they live where they live by experience, and as they get pulled and moved around, you know, they're not all in a perfect 100-foot grid square. So, no, a new square was not created.
This was just basically the same space as the floating docks.
Yes.
Which was initially one mooring, or before the floating dock was there?
Are you here, Gene?
The history on these are that initially there was one mooring block, one boat. Then a floating dock was tied to that float, that mooring. And then because it was swinging, they ended up putting another mooring block on the other end of it. That created a mooring
floating dock.
Okay. That was then split apart, creating two moorings. And that was allowable, and that was allowed. But if either one of those entities, Jim Entwistle or Associated, wished to sell one of those moorings, then they would not be able to. They can keep what they've got, but they can't sell that extra one. Does that make sense?
Because it wasn't
laid. It's really one mooring.
Right.
Now it's two moorings, or a half a mooring in each one, whatever you want to call it.
Thanks, Gene.
Okay. Any other discussion, Ron? Dana? Neil? Lynn? Comments from the audience? No? I hear a motion.
I'll make that motion that we recommend approval as staff recommended.
I hear a second. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion passes. Okay, the last one here, I think, that we're discussing, which is a defined appeal process. This was brought up that we really don't have an appeal process here in the city of Morro Bay on any action. So I think this is a good thing to have a formal procedure written out.
Yeah, I mean, anybody can appeal a decision that a department makes and appeal it to the next level and eventually go to council, but there is no defined appeal process within our rules and regulations, and most entities and harbors and municipalities do have a defined appeal process. Some limit them to very specific instances, like what they can appeal. But again, everything's appealable. But putting a defined appeals process in, gives staff clear direction on where things go and gives the public clear direction on where they can go. So the Harbor Advisory Board wished to put in an appeals process. I think in the staff report, did I put some appeals information in there? I think I put some in there. So currently, like I say, there's no defined appeals process within the harbor rules and regulations. Myrna Municipal Code 1.03 has an appeal process for hearings for administrative citations. That's when the administrative citation process was put in place. So that does exist. An administrative, what we're recommending is approval of administrative or appeal process for administrative decisions of the department, which could run a gamut of things from, denial of a liveaboard permit to lien processing a vessel for non-payment of fees and assignment of slips and operability and seaworthiness, all the stuff where we have to make a judgment call, defining an appeals process that somebody that feels wrong can appeal that to the next highest authority and go from there. So we're recommending the appeals process be approved, and we'll create one. And with an ascending chain of command, logically, whether it's a decision of some of my staff, Harvard starts with the Harvard director and then goes to the city manager. Harvard Advisory Board would be a logical next step, kind of like we do with the SLIP qualification waiver request, and then ultimately city council.
Alan?
You don't think that's too cumbersome? You think that is a reasonable approach?
I mean, hopefully everything we do doesn't become an appeal. Every decision I make or every decision some of my parole officers make, hopefully every single thing doesn't become an appeal. I wouldn't think so. I mean, I don't have people busting down my door now screaming, yelling that, they want to appeal something to somebody else. And so I don't expect we're changing our ways and means of operating in the future. So I don't expect it's going to be a rush of people trying to appeal things. But going from harbor director to city manager, harbor advisory board, I mean, that puts an extra step in there, but I think it's a good one because it's harbor related stuff.
Okay.
Lynn?
Yes, my only question was going to be in this route of appeal, the chain of command, because on some things a first appeal is made to the Harbor Advisory Board and then goes to the director, city manager, etc. The exceptions for the SLIP qualifications, some of those things are set up that way.
The SLIP qualification one, and I think I put in the waiver, that's if I deny a waiver. If Alan requests a waiver for SLIP qualification and I say, no, I'm not going to give you the waiver, that's appealable to the Harbor Advisory Board. We've also brought appeals when folks are out of waivers to get a kind of a last and final waiver. That's been appealable to the Harbor Advisory Board as well. So those are the only two things that we've really gotten. That I don't think would change under this, because those are already defined appeal processes for those, that very particular instance. So that would remain, because that's an ordinance, so that wouldn't change.
But isn't it correct that those began with the Harbor Department?
Yes. Yeah, an appeal from that nature for the SLIP would always start with the Harbor Department.
They skipped the city manager.
Yeah, I just guess I don't quite understand why one appeal would be different from another appeal, since in both cases they are decisions of the harbor director or his staff.
I think the difference is that for the SLIP qualifications, there's already a defined process for that one by ordinance. It was already crafted.
So So why would you not follow the same process of appeal?
Because that ordinance only addresses slip qualifications. The only
right, but you're establishing a appeals process. You have a, an established appeals process for one kind of thing,
correct,
for one kind of decision.
Correct.
So I don't.
There's more than one process, right?
Yeah. Why that appeals process never included the city manager? Probably when it was created, it was probably the city administrator back then, as the titles changed. Why it didn't include the city administrator or city manager? I don't know. The council chose to make it straight to the Harbor Advisory Board for whatever reason back in the 1980s when that was done.
Well, if I understand, and Lynn, don't let me speak for you, speak for yourself. As I understand Lynn's point, she's asking why not include whatever this other cornucopia of possible appeal issues are in that ordinance? Why not address that ordinance, expand the scope of that ordinance?
Gives us too much power.
You could, but again, that ordinance is very specific to slip qualification. Personally, I think that an appeal process that includes the city manager is a good process, because that, you know, that follows the chain of command. Again, why we that ordinance for the slip qualification went straight from harbor director to harbor advisory board, I don't know. I just did.
So if I'm leading this chain of commands, if you make a decision, someone appeals it, they would have to go to the city manager. If they happen to deny the appeal, then it would come to the Harbor Advisory Board. And if we denied it, then it would go to the City Council. Is that correct?
Correct.
And they would make the final decision. They could override the first three, or they could agree with the first three.
Correct.
Okay.
And again, I don't see this being, you know, a big flood of people coming to appeal.
Right.
And again, to answer the Lynn's concern and Ron's question, that resolution, 2391, resolution establishing procedure to qualify as a commercial vessel for the purposes of leasing city docking facilities. It's not just defining an appeals process. It's defining an additional, in addition to the Muni Code that has that one paragraph that says what a commercial fishing boat is, this gave the alternate methods for qualifying with fuel or other fish tickets. So it's more than just an appeal. It just happens to have defined an appeal process in it. So it's very specific to fish dock slip qualification.
Okay. Lynn, do you have any other questions?
No.
Okay.
No, that's okay.
Ron?
What's troubling?
Oh, well, I just don't understand why, if you already have an appeal process established, why not follow the same appeal process?
Well, another way
but
might be to go.
The reason in his case, as I understand what Eric says, is that that's the way that particular thing was decided way back when. We don't really want to tamper with the ordinance as it is. Certainly not. And it does not include the city manager.
Right. I think that's the...
And that's the big point. It does not include the city manager, and he wants to include that step, and that makes sense to me.
Yeah, I mean, Harbor Advisory Board could certainly recommend or
no,
wish to not include the city manager.
Yeah.
I think that makes for kind of a lopsided process, and why they did that on that, I don't know. It's just the way they did it.
I mean, another way to go would be to actually go with the recommendation that we have for the appeals process and then maybe pull that one into it, the slip qualification. So that we don't have to, but then
except
again,
that means you're going to rewrite that ordinance.
And I think that
and I
works.
Don't think we want to do
no,
that.
We already discussed that.
Okay.
I think, yeah. Gene, your thoughts?
I would go with staff recommendation on this one.
Alan? Okay. Do we hear a motion here?
Anyone? I moved that we recommend the defined appeals process as is stated in staff recommendations.
I hear a second.
I'll second that.
Okay, I hear a first and second. Any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Okay, Eric, do you have, so we finished, you know, a lot of rules and regulations. We formed an ad hoc committee for the risk liability to the city to discuss some things. Thank you very much, Lynn. Seriously, I think you're going to open our eyes and help us here. So the next on the agenda, I'm sorry? Okay.
Since we're talking about harbor rules and regulations, I have a question or a comment. Exhibit A is the rules and regulations. And in paragraph 1, after the introduction, it says, no person may live aboard a non-transient vessel in excess of 4 days without first obtaining a permit as provided for in the Morro Bay Municipal Code. That is incorrect. No, it's neither 4 nor 14. After you're here for 60 days, if you're going to live aboard, you have to apply for a permit. And then you need a permit if you are living aboard in excess of 4 days a week, carrying out the normal activities of living. So it's really not in excess of 4 days.
You're correct. And there's a lot of things I intend to clean up on this and reorganize this whole document. There's a lot more to it than 4 days. It's 4 days and night, days or nights, and you have to be here for more than 60 days. And
okay.
Yeah,
okay.
There's
so you have
why that was written there, and then it says, well, go to section 1540 is where it really is.
Right.
Yeah, that could be cleaned up. Noted.
Just something that kind of jumped out at me.
I have a question. At what point does a boat change from being a transient boat to a Morro Bay boat? I mean,
60 days.
So the first 60 days you're here, you're still called a transient?
For live aboard permit requirement purposes, they put 60 days on that. So I'm assuming, and that ordinance was put in place right before I started working here in the early 90s. I believe that number came from, okay, a sailboat comes up and down the coast and they want to stay for a while. 60 days probably is going to cover it. Fishing boat, they're looking at different seasons. While some seasons may go a little longer, they figured 60 days was a reasonable number to not wrap those people up in that net.
Okay. Well, the rule just says non-transient, so I was trying to...
That's it, 60 days.
Yeah. Okay, Eric. As we move forward here, the next item on the agenda is the update from the Marine Services Facility Boatyard Ad Hoc Committee. Ron, do we have anything to report?
Yes, but given that my current information came from the city's liaison, which is the harbor director, I would ask the harbor director to give us a concise update.
Okay. Eric?
Sure. So the latest and greatest from Lisa Wise Consulting, they've completed a local haul-out number and revenue projection chart, basically, or page, I think starting back in maybe late January, early February, they'd provided a fairly robust set of charts and projections and numbers that was rather confusing and convoluted. Through comments, I think I got comments from the ad hoc committee and the fishermen's organization and myself. They boiled it down really to one page, which was good. It made it a lot more clear and easy to read. So that is now going into the draft report, which is pretty close to being at the public review draft stage. They are revising the numbers. I got out of my office last week, believe it or not, drove a boat, can remember how, and went up and down the entire bay, and I reparked the boat without touching the slip. But anyhow, I went and did a physical count of all the boats in the bay and came up with a nice even 450. Wow. So I know we've been using 500. I know it's been thrown around several times in here. What's the number? And because the previous market analysis or feasibility, boatyard feasibility study had 430 odd some boats. We counted empty slips that we knew had Morro Bay boats in them, but all the way back in the State Park Marine and not counting transient boats. So the number was 450. So LWC is taking that new number and they're going to revise their numbers on this sheet. It doesn't appear that it, while it's about, I think, what is it, 10% maybe, it doesn't appear to materially change their assumptions and their findings in any substantial way, so they're going to be incorporating the new numbers in. Hopefully, knock on wood, although I won't, in theory, we'll be seeing this by the end of the week, which is tomorrow, but I'm hoping at it, the very latest, early next week, we'll see the draft report and then get that out for public comment and Harbor Advisory Board review and ad hoc committee review and see where we're going to go with it. Hopefully we've got something we can take to council for some sort of review and action.
Yeah, Dana?
Yeah, how does that go out to public review?
Henry and I talked about several options. I think obviously the ad hoc committee is going to have a hand in it, looking at it and providing comments. I think most likely a Harbor Advisory Board, you know, with ad hoc and staff and Fishermen's Organization input, we run it by the Harbor Advisory Board because ultimately the council is going to be wrestling with it to figure out whether we're doing anything more with it. And I think a good Harbor Advisory Board review of it and a recommendation one way or another is going to be valuable for the council, and they're going to be expecting that anyhow.
Thank you. Lynn?
So does that mean it'll be on next month's agenda? Or will we get it in some form before that?
I think we'll have the ad hoc committee take a good look at it, and the Fisherman's Org and myself, and then it'll get to the agenda. I'll have to look and see, certainly we can get it to the Harbor Advisory Board sooner, I would think, if we need to, so there's ample time for review. I think the ad hoc committee, probably the most proper method is going to get the ad hoc committee to weigh in on it and you know, make recommendations or findings or whatever, and then whether or not we're going to be doing any back and forth, if history repeats itself, I suspect we'll be requesting LWC to make some changes to it, but we'll see. And so I don't want to release anything to the Harbor Advisory Board too soon in that it may change between now and when it actually gets to the Harbor Advisory Board for public review. So we'll have to weigh process there and get the ad hoc committee's input and the Fisherman Org input and get that back and forth done. I'm hopeful we can get it done for the April meeting. We need to keep it moving forward, so that would be my view of how we would go with it.
Thank you. Ron?
When the report does get on the agenda for the Harbor Advisory Board, I would encourage the entire board, not just the members of the ad hoc committee, to very carefully review it. So, I would not be comfortable, speaking as only one member of that committee, I would not be comfortable with the committee simply making a recommendation to the Harbor Advisory Board and the Harbor Advisory Board either taking the recommendation or not taking the recommendation. This is a pretty big deal in the city, so please, the whole board, take a look at it when the time comes.
Any other questions here?
Okay.
So we tried to have a meeting on the Capital Improvement Planning Ad Hoc Committee. I was deathly ill for the first time in 40 years. So I did have a phone meeting with Ron and Neil, but I've talked to Eric a little bit since, and we're going to get together to meet, and you wanted to talk about it a little bit?
Yeah, so thanks, Bill. So we are starting into budgeting. I've got my preliminary sheets from finance, and we're starting to crunch numbers. And like I said, the last Tuesday, council grappled with some goals and objectives and put their priorities on what they wanted to see done in some sort of an objective fashion, and then that'll get some numbers attached to it, and we'll bring it back. So we're my revenue and expenditure estimates are due to the city finance director and March 20th, I think it is. There's a couple of budget. I have my numbers or my files in front of me, but there's a couple of budget hearings, study sessions before it goes to council. So, and then there's this very brand newly created financial oversight committee, citizens oversight committee, that's looking more at general fund. But one way I'm kind of looking at this capital improvement planning ad hoc committee is kind of a component of a financial oversight independent of my staff time and getting some review on it. So we'll be looking to the ad hoc committee and putting that committee together, a meeting a couple times over the next couple of weeks to look at capital improvement and where we've got fund, what our funding is, what our estimates are, look at the capital list of needs. And I think we wrap up general budget. While I don't anticipate asking the Harbor Advisory Board or the ad hoc committee for input on you know, line item by line item, how much to budget for, I think the bigger global picture of you know, where we want to set Harbor Advisory Board's goals and priorities is a good function of that committee as well. So we'll be hopefully getting together.
So your so if your first meeting with the city is March 20th, then we need to meet, and you're going to go on Sunday. Do you have your calendar that we could set a meeting, our first one?
I will be back on Thursday night, the March, I say the 12th.
Yeah, what about the 16th on Monday? How about the 17th? You'll be here?
No.
18th? Okay. So, Neil? 18th.
Depends on the time. We can do it before 11.
Do we meet in your office, Eric?
Yeah. Can I throw out another date?
Yeah.
It's not a happy date. Friday the 13th?
No. In the early in the morning.
That's a bad day.
I can't do that
either. Oh. Okay. So.
It's a bad day.
The 18th, is that, would that work at all for you, Eric?
The 18th works for me. Oh, Lori's writing something on me, on my calendar. Oh, no.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay.
Yes, 18th.
Okay. I'll talk to you later, Eric, on it. The 18th sounds good, though.
Okay.
Thank you very much. And so your next agenda item is the review of harbor lease sites with construction or other lease site activity currently underway.
Right. So I'm going to try and go fairly quickly. I don't know that we got this to the Harbor Advisory Board last year, but we've traditionally tried to kind of just do a brief overview of all the lease sites with something going on, whether that's lease negotiations or construction or whatnot. So I'm going to run down the list. It would be easier if someone has a question as I go along, throw something at me, raise your hand, make noise, and I can stop and answer questions, or I can wait to the end. Preference, doesn't matter.
If you could, you already have some suggested activities, construction negotiations, redevelopment proposals, or other, as you go down through here, could you label them?
Yeah, I'll be explaining each one what's going on. Yeah. No, it's just if a question comes up while we're talking about one, I'll stop at the end of each one and see if there's any questions, and we'll just go from there. I'm starting from south to north because that's the way our lease sites are numbered, low to high. 30W, 33W, that's Bayfront Marina, the old fuel dock. recently bought by a couple of couples that bought it from Jay and Marilyn Coakley. They're working, and although Gene, you may know more than I on what they're doing down there. They've got plans to do some pier repair. I think they've already done some. They committed to a timeline to do a fair amount of dock improvements. They're also looking at the potential of going to State Lands Commission jointly with the city and readjusting their real property line, the lease line, because the lease line cuts through their buildings in kind of an odd way. So we'll be looking at whether that's doable or not. But it's pretty much on them to continue on doing what they're supposed to be doing. Questions? Or Gene, you got any comments on that? Okay, next up, and for some reason I forgot to put it in here. It didn't slip in the middle. 35W, 36W, that's the old cannery lease site where they used to have a wharf that was removed. Council direction from a couple of years ago was work with those upland property owners on their proposal, the Martinis on their proposal to build out a dock there. Those talks kind of got stalled for a while for numerous reasons, but we've recently kind of rewarmed them up and waiting on a proposal from them to see what they intend to do there, if anything. Next, anything on that? Nope. 37W, that's the boatyard, Morro Bay Marina, they call it. The old Meyer property, it's now in ownership of the heirs of Al Myers and company there. So waiting on them for a proposal on what they're going to do with that boatyard and those slips. There's not much, you know, to do in the water there except the slips. But we're looking for the proposal on how they intend to operate it. They do want to keep the lease site. I believe they intend to try and keep operating the boatyard, but haven't gotten a definitive proposal on that yet, so we'll be looking for that. Any questions? Nope. 62W, that's Kayak Horizons. We took that to City Council. I may have reported this out already, but we took this to Council a meeting or three ago where the owner, Dennis Kruger, is been talking with the new owners of the Gray's Inn next door, Todd and Tamara Baston, about the Bastons buying that lease site, taking it over, and doing some improvements incorporated with the improvements they've already gotten an okay on to start on the Gray's Inn side. So we'll be hopefully looking for that purchase of that lease site to move on and hopefully some new improvements there. Questions? Nope.
So Gray's Inn is thinking about purchasing Kayak Horizons?
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah, and adding some
room
space and keeping the kayak dock there and whatnot. So what that will consist of in the future, if it continues forward and is successful between those two parties, is they'll come to City Council for an assignment assumption of the lease site if they come to an agreement to buy it, and then the new owners will put out their proposal and get consent of landowner to do what they want to do and hopefully move those two processes concurrently together on both sides. Gray's Inn and Gallery talked about that. They're working on their submittals to planning and building, getting their architectural stuff done, submitting to planning and building department to keep that process moving forward. Questions? 68W, that's the VLA lease site. As you know, the Held and VLA were the two kind of mirror lease sites that rebuilt.
What about the salt building?
Oh, did I skip one? Oh, skipped one. 65, 66. Yeah. Someday we need to rename these things something else. It's just too clunky. But anyhow, Abba Imani at the salt building, his release to get X number of years on it required him to do some improvements. He put in fire sprinklers underneath the new deck and upgrade his fire sprinkler system. He got his signs all permitted. He was under some council direction to get some compliance issues complied with, get the restroom publicly available. Still a work in progress on a couple items there, but the main thing, the construction of the public walkway connecting through to VLA next door, and he had to put in a handicap lift, ADA accessible lift in there, and then put in the sprinklers. He's gotten all that done. He's got that all signed off, which was the major thing that got stalled for quite a while. Questions? Nope. So VLA, Held and VLA. So the northern of those two mirror images, you know, they got rebuilt with the one retail unit up front, new slip out back, and then the hotel upstairs and downstairs. The Held sold out to the VLAs, so now VLA owns both of those lease sites. They're still independent lease sites, but now it's one operator there. And it's up and running and looks great and seems to be getting a fair amount of business. 8285, Rose's Landing, Doug Redican. I think he's going to Planning Commission next month.
What happened to the aquarium?
Did I skip the aquarium?
Yeah.
Well, we'll come back to it. There's not much really to report there, but Doug Redican proposing to put in slips as part of his lease requirements. He's been back and forth in planning and building for, I won't say how long, a long time. He's, it looks like he's going to Planning Commission fairly soon, hopefully next month, to get their final approval on that, and hopefully he can get going and start building slips. Aquarium, nothing really new there. The Avila Aquarium folks are still interested in, from what we understand, operating that site. We're actually going down tomorrow. City manager, a couple of folks from council, myself, to go meet with them at Avila and see where they're at and see where their intentions may be. 8686W, that is 801 Embarcadero LLC, otherwise known as Libertine Pub. Bert Caldwell is pretty close. I had some conversations with him maybe a month or month and a half ago. Getting all his drawings, he's proposed to basically level the whole lease site there, whole building, build in a new smaller restaurant and brew pub, and do some nice improvements on where he's got the parking and do, I don't want to say a parklet, but do some public improvements out front there, attached to the street end. And he's getting ready to submit all those plans to planning and building to move forward on that. So hopefully we'll see that before too much longer. Next door, 8787W, off the hook. Also, old lease that's due for total rebuild. They're proposing to demolish that whole building and rebuild in a new one-story combination retail restaurant with keeping the open space where those little kids' games and rides are. They've submitted their plans to planning and building. They've been kicking them back and forth, as your typical planning and building process. You make corrections and whatnot. So they're in the hopper and moving on that, which is good. 9395, the Harbor Center, that's the Held's other, only remaining lease site now. That's the site that's got Poppy and Hofbrau. They've submitted for their precise plans. They're proposing to put in slips. They're also putting in slips back behind, what was their Anchor restaurant?
It was Anchor Cafe.
Yeah, now it's Juju. The Juju restaurant, Juju Cafe. He's putting in slips back there and then putting in a small retail unit. He got through Coastal Commission approvals. He didn't come out unwounded. Coastal put some fairly draconian things on his permits, but he's dealing with it moving forward. And he's hoping, I think Lori contacted him today, he's hoping to break ground sometime this fall, possibly November. So hopefully we'll see that. Questions? Nope. Well, yell if you got any questions. 96, Van Buren, and it was Roca's when I wrote this. I guess now it's Juju's. Waiting on a proposal from him. He's got some lease requirements to do some improvements there that kind of got stalled for a while for various reasons. Well, we've recently started conversations with Mr. Van Buren again and kind of see what his completed proposal is to continue operating that site on into the future. It's probably the smallest lease site we have in terms of width. That or Kayak Horizons are both pretty limited in what they can do there. 102, 102W, 105.1W, 105.2W, two different groups of lease sites there. 102 and 102W, that's the lease site on the south end that where the new slips were put in, where the restaurant is, and the fish shack there. We're taking that to council in, it looks like April, for direction on whether to work with the existing leaseholders. It's a Pipkin lease. It expires in 2018. So we're going to council in April to get council direction on whether or not to work with that leaseholder, put out for RFP. And then the oddball one about that one is we like the leases down at the south end. We don't own the land. Our lease site does cut through that restaurant building to a certain degree, which is going to make it interesting. But it's mostly water lease site. And then 105.1.2, that's the fuel dock. Sue Lichtenbaum had been negotiating with Gio de Guerremore on that, with Rob Schultz. And with Sue's passing, that pretty much stopped. And Rob never took it back up. And then Rob's gone. I was getting ready to start taking it up, and then Mike de Guerremore passed away. So there's been just a lot of mitigating factors that have just stalled that one forever. So I've just started talking to Giovanni again. And he's talking to his mom, Ori, about what they want to do there. So we'll most likely, assuming council agrees to continue working with them on the other lease site, maybe a combined negotiation effort to get those ones done. 110, 112, W, Great American Fish Company. Gangway's been, you know, they started on their project. As you know, they got permitted through the city and coastal to do a total dock rebuild that was going to connect to Harbor Hut, that was going to connect to Fowler's, then Verges, and it was one big permit that since has had to kind of get pulled back apart. Great American Fish Company put in their dock and put in a gangway. Gangway didn't quite meet the city's building code specs, so they've been back to the drawing board on that. But hopefully they'll get the gangway either replaced or repaired and get that permit finaled and complete what's going on there. The oddball thing with the Great American Fish Company is that there were two amendments to that lease back in 2012 when George League was on the council that essentially been declared null and void because he was on council and they weren't supposed to have been done while he was on council. So we're going to have to take him back to city council and see where he wants to go with those, so, and see where the council takes that. So he had two 10-year options to add onto his lease. One was for the docks and gangway, and I believe the second one was for maybe a fish market and some improvements between the restaurant and the tea pier. So we'll be taking that to council and see where we want to go with that. 122, 123, Harbor Hut, they had gotten city council approval, planning commission approval to put an upstairs office and some storage space. To open up some space and some break room area to really make the restaurant more efficient. Went to Coastal Commission. Coastal approved it, but then a lawsuit was filed against it claiming violation of Measure D, which states that the existing grandfathered uses cannot be enlarged or expanded. And the city's interpretation of that going through the whole city council concept and precise and planning commission approval and the coastal commission approval agreed that they're not putting in more seating, they're not putting in more restaurant capacity, they're not expanding the restaurant out into other areas, they're expanding up to make the restaurant more efficient. That was deemed not an expansion of that use. Well, that's what the lawsuit was about. And fortunately for Troy League, the owner there, it was a lawsuit against the coastal commission, so the state of California defended it and successfully defended it, and it's been tossed. So Mr. League is going to continue forward with that, hopefully in the near future, and get that project underway. 124, 128, and 113, Morbay Landing. I've been working with Mr. Fowler on another amendment to his lease to try and account for the amount of work he's doing and planning on doing in terms of lease terms. Phase 1A, the docks right in front of the landing are done and all finaled and everything's in. He's pretty close on 1B, on the docks in, on the other side of Harbor Hut. It's not just going to be alongside Tiny Moore. He's putting in some slips as well. So that's getting pretty close to getting finaled. And then he's working on plans for the building and tearing down the building and rebuilding that. And then the Tognazzini's 3, the old Fishboat restaurant back in the day, that gets leveled and turned into pocket park. So we've been working with Fowler on possible other uses, which may be the restroom for if the Coast Guard project ends up moving forward, maybe the public restroom can go over there. So a few things in motion there, but nothing definitive. But I've been working with Fowler on doing that amendment to his lease. 129 to 131, Morbay Fish Company. We're still negotiating with Santa Monica Seafood. That lease is on holdover. We're pretty darn close. We're really the only outstanding issue is the ice house and how we run it into the future. Unfortunately, ice is not, I don't want to say this, but I will, a hot commodity. good one, huh?
That was good, Eric.
That machine requires a lot of maintenance, a lot of upkeep. There's a lot of utility cost to it. If we moved more ice, it might be a break even at best, but it's not. It loses money. And it's got some pretty big maintenance items coming up, and that's been the sticking point of negotiating because the tenant obviously doesn't want to be on the hook too much for those, and understandably so because it's a big cost. So we're trying to work out some details on that and get back on track and get the new lease penciled in there. And I'm hopeful. I think we've got an tentative agenda for the April 1st meeting, Lori? Yeah, I think April 14th. I'm hopeful, again, knock on wood, that we'll get that wrapped up. And last but not least, 144W, now Morabay Oyster Company. Used to be Chuck Marciel and M&M Refrigeration. As you know, Neil just bought that lease, and he is moving forward on continuing on operating that lease site and doing some more improvements and keeping it up and running. End of my report.
Alan, do you have a question?
And just real quick, of all the slips that are, when you counted the votes in the harbor, did that include slips that are under construction now, or, and how will that affect that final number of boats in Morro Bay?
I did not count slips. I mean, there really is nothing. Is there anything under? There's nothing under construction right now. Fowler's close.
Approved.
No, that's a good point. So, and some of Fowler's slips are still empty. Assuming he gets those rented, you know, there's three or four more there, and then he's adding, what, four or five, Gene, on the other side. Yeah. Doug Redican's adding, I think, six. Smith Held's adding probably about that much. So we're going to be back at 500 here pretty soon. Keep working at it.
Thank you, Eric. Any other questions? Ron?
Eric, there was a recent newspaper article, the Bay News, about the audit of waterfront leaseholders.
Yeah, came out today.
Was it? Oh, forget that. Would you give us a brief status report on the audit, ongoing audit, please, and also the future plans for auditing?
Sure. So I'll have to read the Bay News. I've not seen that.
Neil Farrell.
Oh, thanks, Neil. So the long overdue and long taking a long time audits, we've got, and Lori can chime in if she wants, we've got, I want to say roughly maybe we've gotten a third of them. So we decided to audit all 30 master lease sites and go back and capture 3 years, which in hindsight was a big chunk to bite off, and I probably wouldn't bite off that much in the future, but we did, and we're struggling through it. About a third of the leases are what we call ready to report. They've got findings. We're slowly but surely getting to those leaseholders, writing them the letters, saying here's our findings. Some of them are resolved and are pretty simple and easy. Some of them are folks are disputing because there's decent amounts of money owed. But we're getting through those. A large percentage of our lease sites didn't provide sufficient information for the auditor to make findings. And so he's going back, and we had to get some extra funding because it had been way more detailed and cumbersome than any of us had anticipated. Leaseholders, us and the auditor included, went back for some extra funding to complete it. He's going in and basically taking sales tax reports, which we have, the city gets, you know, through the state, and comparing those to what the lease sites reported at the year end, and using those. And so we'll be bringing that hopefully to a conclusion in the not too distant future. Knocking on a lot of wood tonight, and finishing up those findings into the future. What I'm planning on doing is, once we get these behind us, I'm planning on budgeting a certain amount every year and doing them on an ongoing basis. My thought was, since we're supposed to do them every 5 years, splitting them roughly into fifths and doing a fifth of them every year. And so when we get through a whole five-year cycle, we've been through all the lease sites. The trick of that is going to be you don't want it to be predictable because the possibility of an audit, I think, needs to be somewhat random, to ensure that there's, for lack of a better word, keeping people honest and not making it so predictable. How we're going to weave through that, I'm not quite sure, but that's the intent in the future, is just audit a fifth of them every year and on a continuous basis. It's been probably 8 or 9 years since we'd done them last, so that's why we did all of them at once and did 3 years.
Mr. Farrell suggested some numbers. Are you in a position to discuss some numbers as it relates to the findings of the audit?
Do you have any specifics? I've not seen any.
I believe Ron, Eric mentioned the last meeting that revenues are exceeding $250,000. I think it was $250,000 than what you budget, or $2.4 million, and you budgeted $1.7 million. That's what was reported in the
last
paper.
Last year, is that what's in the article?
I believe so.
Okay, well, it's a newspaper.
Well, what I was specifically addressing was not revenue for the not revenue in terms of budget. I'm talking about the results of the audit.
The results, without having read it, exactly what Mr. Farrell's reported, some of our audits have revealed that the tenants owe money. There's actually a couple that we owe because they overpaid, and there's some that are pretty dead even that are just within parameters. But I can't comment specifically that article just because I don't have it, and I don't know what Mr. Neal's reporting.
Any other questions? Okay. Well, next on the agenda here, where are we right now? It's getting a little late. Future agenda items. So we have a full schedule. I mean, I would love to see in April the ad hoc committee for the boat haul off facility, if as long as it's available. And then also, again, the Marine Sanctuary. I don't know if April is the thing. And then we also had the marina, the State Park Marina.
Yeah, I think that we could invite the Morro Bay Commercial Fishermen's Organization to maybe give a presentation on the on what's going on there with the sanctuary areas. Is that a possibility, or is there another way to go about that?
Well, we need someone to probably discuss it, the ramifications, if we're going to hold a hearing. I mean, it's not just because we don't know.
Is that something staff would want to do? Or I just thought, since Jeremiah already came and talked about it, he's going to be up on it.
He has that piece of paper that might be public in a month. So could you ask him?
Yeah, I mean, if you're looking for a future agenda, which I believe we are, and it sounds like April, if you're looking, I guess the intention is the board going to take a position or make a recommendation? I can provide the staff report with whatever background may be pertinent. Obviously, the current effort and what's been done, and what Jeremiah spoke about in terms of who supports it and how the process has unfolded. Obviously, that would be there. Some history of the existing standing council resolutions, the CMAQ position, and that sort of thing, and throw it out there to the board and the public to weigh in and see if the Harbor Advisory Board wants to take a position and recommend to council one way or another. I looked earlier, and I looked on my tentative agenda planning stuff that I've gotten from the city clerk, and I did not see sanctuary yet on there. I think the mayor's maybe waiting to see what we find out in D.C. Before we start putting that on the agenda. But I didn't see it on there, at least through I think the first meeting in April was as far as I saw.
So maybe it would be maybe a staff report the next meeting?
Well, this would be our last chance.
I think it needs to be on the next agenda because time is of the essence. So it would be too late for us after they get back from D.C. to then deal with it in the future meeting.
So how would you like to handle it? You know, I mean, in reporting, I mean, is there...
I think Eric, if we could get a presentation from Jeremiah or have the information in the staff report that could possibly include information that Jeremiah has, if that report that he's talked about now for, I don't know how long he's had that report. I know he can't release it yet, but he's talked about it. And as soon as that information is public, it'd be great to get that to us.
Yeah, I mean, I think my thoughts are that will become publicly available in the wide range of places once that is able to be made.
We have a good suggestion. Maybe you can invite the Sierra Club or the Shumash. I mean, if they're the ones proposing it, that's who we want to hear it from. I think that's not a bad idea.
That's a great idea.
To get all sets.
I think the Sierra Club, the gentleman who runs it, I forget his name. Does anyone know his name?
Andrew Christie.
Well, I know. He used to be. But I think the Sierra Club or the Shumash would be wonderful, as they say, a 15-minute presentation in the April meeting.
As well as the Morro Bay Commercial Fishermen's Organization.
Yeah, that way they have equal time, not just 3 minutes. We're good.
Yeah, that's going to be a meaty issue, and I got State Park Marina looming too.
I think that's important too. Now, are they ready?
Yeah, that's fine.
In theory, we're ready. That's the plan. We're meeting the 18th, April 18th, yeah. Or March 18th. Sorry. Yeah, I've got a conference call with State Park Marina on the 17th to go over process and see if they are ready.
This is our only time we can talk. This is our last chance to make a
recommendation. Mr. Chairman?
Yes, sir.
If the April meeting focused on just three central issues, you know, and you think in terms of 3 hours, that is potentially an hour per issue, and it may not take an hour for any particular issue. So the sanctuary, the rules and regs thing, I think is very important to keep moving forward. And I just had my mind.
State Park.
Thank
State
you.
Park.
Thank you, Dana. My mind went blank. And the State Park. I mean, does anybody think that there's any other pressing issue?
Alan?
We're talking about the sea lion.
Mike?
The sea lion on the floats issue came up last time, and we talked about it sometime in the future. I don't...
We also have
our... Strike me nearly as important
for the April meeting
as being time pressing.
So... well, why don't we try to focus on those three? Put the rules and regulations as the third item. So in case we can't get to it, that's not as time sensitive as the first two. I mean, if you know, the whole meeting takes over those two issues.
If they do, that
yeah. My guess, I think you're going to find between the State Park Marina and Sanctuary that we're going to burn a lot of time on those.
Well, then.
I mean, we can put the rules and regulations.
Yeah, and then if we
go third, if there's time.
Right. Okay.
So. We also were talking about earlier about the haul out facility continuing. That we would all have our reports and be able to go over them. I mean, if we have to push that back, I think what we have is more pressing.
I agree.
Well, the sanctuary thing. I mean, it depends on how it's managed on the agenda. It doesn't have to take 3 hours or 2 hours or even 1 hour, depending on how it's managed.
Depends on how many people show up and want to talk.
Okay.
But this is only so we can. So, Mr. Chairman, you can put a time limit on the agenda item because it's not the only forum available for the public on the sanctuary. That the council, you know, we had a council person telling us that it's also going to be available with the city council. So
let's. That's a good idea. Let's put a time limit on the sanctuary of 1 hour. Is that reasonable, Eric?
It's up to the meeting if that's what you want to do. I think if we invite the Sierra Club, I can probably guarantee there's going to be a lot of people in the audience.
Yeah.
That are all going to want their, and we're going to have to, I'm going to have to learn how to use that timer.
Well, you know what?
One minute.
I think we need to do it, though. Okay. So that's my suggestion. Ron?
Future agenda item. We're still talking about future agenda items. Eric, when the Harbor Advisory Board is done with what you would like it to address about the rules and regs, does the department want any input from the Harbor Advisory Board relative to best management practices for the harbor? Because that was also on the department's agenda for an update.
Are you asking if we should combine those two?
No, I'm asking if when we're done with the rules and regs process that is in place now, if you see any utility in having the Harbor Advisory Board involved with the review of best management practices, which is sort of a standalone item.
I mean, if you want to make it a future agenda item, or do we already have that on the list?
We don't.
I mean, it sounds like you're talking more of a timing. Would that be the time to do it?
No, my question is whether there's any utility in your opinion as harbor director, and whatever you say is fine, whether there's any utility in the Harbor Advisory Board getting involved in some review process relative to best management practices for the harbor.
Yes, I think there's potential utility there. Sure.
Then I'm suggesting to add it as a future agenda item.
Do I hear anyone else that'd like to add on to that?
I think it would be good education for all of us.
Okay. So we do have support on that. So Eric, we'll talk and see how we want to approach these topics. And we'll come up with a solution. And we'll have a good meeting in April.
We will have a good meeting in April.
Okay. Do I hear a motion to adjourn?
I move that we adjourn.
I hear a first and a second. Any discussion? Seeing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Ron, just FYI, I mean, for pertinent...